Well, good day, everyone. I would like to welcome you to day two of a workshop entitled Climate Intervention in an Earth System Science Framework. My name is Jim Hurl, and I am the Scott Chair of Environmental Science and Engineering and a Professor of Atmospheric Science at Colorado State University. And I've had the distinct pleasure of serving as the Chair of the Organizing Committee for this workshop. And again, I welcome all of you attending online today. As I did on Tuesday, which was the first day of this virtual workshop, I'd like to remind all participants of our expectations for conduct. The National Academies are committed to fostering a professional, respectful, and inclusive environment where all can participate fully in a harassment-free and discrimination-free atmosphere. We look to each and every one of you to help us maintain a professional and cordial environment. Further details on the Academy's policy on preventing discrimination, harassment, and bullying is available on the website. Now, turning to this workshop, in September of 2021, the National Academies released the consensus study, Next Generation Earth System Science at the National Science Foundation. The report called for an Earth System Science initiative that emphasizes research on complex interactions and feedbacks between natural and social processes. And it's in this context that this workshop, very appropriately, on climate intervention research has been formulated. Specifically, the organizing committee was asked to convene researchers from across the many different physical, ecological, and social science dimensions involved in climate intervention research to explore convergent research pathways that would embody the goals of an ESS framework. On day one, our opening session framed the discussion of climate intervention from both a human dimensions perspective and a physical sciences perspective. The participants in that session discussed research design, how to assess risk relative to the risk of climate change, societal and physical systems implications of climate intervention, unintended consequences, natural and social system interactions, as well as the essential need for governance research. Importantly, this opening session presented key concepts and frameworks to inform how the following sessions consider specific techniques and applications. So on Tuesday, we had two following sessions. The first discussed the state of research, the societal acceptance, and the governance considerations surrounding solar climate intervention or solar geoengineering. And then the next session discussed the same issues for land-based carbon dioxide removal and sequestration strategies. So turning to today, we will first consider ocean-based CDR approaches, which include a suite of proposed climate intervention, whose governance considerations, as well as approaches to technological development, are very critical to consider. And then our final closing session of the workshop a bit later will synthesize key insights and needs identified from the prior discussions with an eye toward actionable steps for the National Science Foundation in the context of next-generation Earth System science. We'll then close the workshop with some synthesis remarks, as well as a very brief summary of next steps and future work from our colleagues at the National Academies. A final note is that we will be using Slido to take questions and comments from the virtual audience. You may ask questions of the presenters in the Q&A tab at any time during the session. Slido also allows participants to upvote questions, and it allows participants to reply to or comment on questions. You can scan this QR code from your phone or go to slido.com and input this code. So at this point, it's my pleasure to get the workshop today started, and I'm going to turn it over to my colleague on the organizing committee, Professor Joellen Russell, who will moderate our next session on ocean-based carbon dioxide removal. Joellen?
equivalent of climate intervention? Could we tell? When would we know? And what choices would we have about that if it were discovered? And I am concerned that right now, you know, we're having trouble making sure that GoShip keeps its funding and that Argo, you know, doesn't decay because of inflation and not enough money for floats. I'm, of course, involved with biogeochemical Argo, as are people like Phil Boyd. And I am deeply concerned that the investment just isn't there. And I'm looking at the NSF's budget and seeing that, you know, OCE is as a percent of total funding in NSF is at an all-time low. OCE being our ocean sciences. So I am concerned that at an all-time low, with an all-time interest in these carbon dioxide removal strategies, I am curious to hear from our keynote speaker here, Margaret Leinen, and from our panelists, where do we start? What should we do? What is the best plan of attack here? What can we expect? What do we need to do as research scientists in order to make progress, given that there is incredible pressure from our commercial and governmental colleagues? To make this happen. So I'm going to let Margaret take it away and kick us off, and she'll have 20 minutes, and I'll give you a 2-minute warning just to be on the safe side. Margaret, if you'd like to give us your remarks, thank you.
Great. Thank you, Joellen. I will share my screen. And now,
is that great? Yep.
So the image here is a satellite image of the Northeast Pacific, and it is reflectance at the wavelength of chlorophyll, so essentially a chlorophyll image. And this little spot circled in yellow is an experiment that was done in 2002 by the Joint Global Ocean Flux Study, and it was an iron enrichment experiment in the Northeast Pacific, focused on whether the technique of adding iron to the surface water would result in enhanced productivity. And as you can see, that little spot did result in enhanced productivity. And that experiment was an example of one of the techniques that have been suggested for marine carbon dioxide removal. And of course, the Academy just last year published a wonderful study that was a research strategy for ocean-based carbon dioxide removal. And that's the cover of the study, and both the a link and the DOI for the study. So ocean-based carbon dioxide removal and sequestration was described in, or several techniques were described for this. And those included techniques that would take place in the ocean, some that add material to the ocean. So the first ocean nutrient fertilization, like the example that I just showed from the series experiment, adding iron to the ocean to because that micronutrient is in, it's iron is extremely insoluble in the ocean, and it's necessary for many steps in photosynthesis. So adding trace amounts of iron in areas that are far away from the nearshore, where the rivers add iron to the water, can result in phytoplankton growth. A second technique that adds material to the ocean is ocean alkalinization. So in using that technique, alkali is added to the ocean, resulting in the uptake of CO2, and then that uptake of CO2 in the ocean results in a flux of CO2 from the atmosphere to the ocean. Then there are techniques that enhance natural processes without the addition of material. So one of those is artificial upwelling, and that's shown in the cartoon here with those purple-colored tube-like structures on the lower left or lower right. In that technique, processes are taken to enhance the movement of water from depths of about 100 to 200 meters, which has enhanced nutrients up to the surface, again, trying to enhance phytoplankton growth and the phytoplankton take up CO2. Another technique for ocean-based carbon dioxide removal is growing algae for further use or and that further use could be sequestration. So one idea is to grow large amounts of algae and then sink it to lower depths in the ocean or to the seafloor. Another idea is enhancing algae growth and then using that for food, biofuel, et cetera. And then one final technique is electrochemical capture and deep sea storage. So this is essentially taking in seawater, whether that's done out at sea or on land, using electrochemical processes to remove the CO2 and then process the seawater and then to extract CO2 from it and store that CO2 somewhere, whether that's in the deep sea or converting it to be transferred into land-based storage. So those are the techniques that have been discussed. One final one that you'll see in the middle is marine ecosystem restoration, and that's essentially techniques like enhancing mangrove reforestation, seagrasses, et cetera, that would be blue carbon solutions to carbon dioxide removal. So as I said, this is a very, very substantial study of ocean-based carbon dioxide removal and sequestration. So what I'm going to focus on is some general comments about what we need to know and what NSF could do to assist that process. I was really taken by a comment that Jim Haywood made on Tuesday, and he said, 20 years from now, what information will we wish we had gathered? And he was referring to other climate intervention techniques, but we could apply that to ocean carbon dioxide removal as well. And so I'll talk a little bit about what we need to know about processes, what we need to know about impacts, and then what do we need to do or to have in place to be able to study either of those, and what could NSF do to assist that process. So for processes, looking at ocean nutrient fertilization, arguably the 20 years of research by the Joint Global Ocean Flux Study and Surface Ocean Lower Atmosphere Study have established a really firm foundation for the processes responsible for stimulating phytoplankton growth by fertilization, especially iron fertilization. Everything from the nature of the ligands associated with iron in phytoplankton to processes for air-sea exchange of the CO2 and so forth. There's been a lot of process work. Most of that work, however, it was related to the fertilization itself and whether phytoplankton would grow as opposed to carbon dioxide removal and its sequestration. So the objective of those experiments was really, would they stimulate phytoplankton growth? Why did they stimulate phytoplankton growth and so forth? Carbon flux sequestration were not objectives and really need attention. For alkalinization, the processes have been studied in some detail in the lab, but processes related to deployment in either the open ocean or near shore, as well as processes related to uptake of CO2, are the big gaps there. For artificial upwelling, processes associated with this have been studied in very small deployments, just testing equipment and whether the upwelling would occur. But a great deal of work would be needed to understand how this activity would scale and then the processes associated with it. Also, in all of these issues of where this carbon dioxide removal work would be located have not really been studied in great detail. So, for example, with artificial upwelling, where this would take place and how it would leverage the deeper layers that are enriched in nutrients has not been given any broad study to say what are the best places to do this. For kelp, processes associated with growing kelp are informed by various kelp aquaculture activities, but processes associated with the sequestration of kelp in the deep ocean have not been studied adequately. And then with hydrolysis, processes associated with that are well known from lab and industrial experience, but a great deal of work would be needed to understand how this activity would scale and the processes associated with it. So one of the key things that you'll see in this is that we know a lot more about the processes that would be stimulated by human activity, but very little about how those would really come together to sequester CO2 and how to actually measure and assess that CO2 sequestration. Impacts. For virtually all of the marine CDR techniques, there is inadequate information on the impacts of the techniques on the physics, for example, with artificial upwelling, on the chemistry of including nutrients. So for example, with the addition of nutrients and phytoplankton growth, a major question that has been asked is, does this rob downstream or upstream areas of nutrients that would be supporting phytoplankton growth? And then especially the impacts on biology and ecosystems. In many areas, this is because the experiments weren't done, but in all of the areas, being able to look at what happens to biology on a scale of a kilometer is very different from being able to look at biology and impacts of ecosystems at the scale that would be needed for any of these techniques to actually remove substantial CO2. So the impact side of this is, for all of these, a big unknown. Lots of papers written based on what we know about natural techniques and their impact on biology and ecosystems, but very little on any experiments themselves. So as was talked about on Tuesday, we've seen a lot of investment in small companies that are looking at various techniques for climate intervention, and that's true in marine carbon dioxide removal as well. And I think a big question is what results will we see from these experiments? And at this point, all of these are largely lab scale experiments. A few have done very small test deployments in the ocean, but really they're looking at issues like the technology itself and how to scale that. I think that we will learn a lot about how to do the next level of experiments from this kind of work, but it's not clear that any of these companies will have the resources to be able to study what the impacts on the marine environment would be, whether that's physics, chemistry, or biology. And I think that another piece is that the demand for being able to show how this is commercialized will soon catch up with all of the companies. And the question of scaling will be an important one. I think that we may, if some of these companies are successful, learn something about scaling, but I'll talk a bit about what it will take to understand the impacts on the ocean. And my own personal opinion is that few of these will have the resources to be able to look at what the impact on the ocean will be. Just a couple comments about where we are with this research. In the U.S., there has been almost no publicly funded research on any of these techniques for at least a decade. And internationally, we're beginning to see some investments abroad, both in Europe and in China. And I think that one of the important things for us to realize is that there are other countries that have the capability of doing this work and will go ahead with that if they see a reason to do it, irrespective of what is happening in the U.S. And I think that we had a lot of discussion on Tuesday about the public and their response to solar radiation management experiments and the environmental movements that largely prevented experiments, even fairly small experiments, from going forward. But no matter how loud our environmental community is about this, there are countries where environmental community action is not likely to be able to impact government or private sector decisions. So an important piece here is that we're no longer the only nation capable of doing this and paying for the research. So I'd like to talk a bit about the roles for NSF, because this study is paid for by NSF and they're trying to look at what their role could be. Is it important for NSF to do this kind of research? And I think that there are two rationales for NSF to play a role. The first is if their funding of research can set an ethical standard for doing the research, essentially abiding by a set of principles. And we heard about principles on Tuesday. Accepting regulation, if that regulation can be developed, and that's a big if, not because of the lack of desire for regulation, but coming to agreement on regulation. And then the inclusion of monitoring and validating the experiments. And this, we've seen a lot of work in this area where monitoring or evaluating carbon removal and sequestration has not been the object of the research, or that it wasn't included. And so I think that something that really work by NSF that included that in the research would be a big step forward. And then assessment. And here, certainly MRV is one part of assessment, but assessment of the way that the research was conducted, whether that was efficient, whether we learned something about technique from the research, whether the public is included in assessment, and the environmental community would be a big step forward. And then whether there was a plan for sequential scaling, from scaling of very small experiments in the ocean to larger experiments, and how would that sequential scaling take place? I think a second piece that would justify NSF to play a role would be if their funding could set a scientific standard for the research in terms of the approach, its efficacy and impacts. So research that really included looking at the chemistry and biology of the ocean affected by this, looking at the level of efficacy and how to measure that. The completeness of field experiments. If field experiments did include that broad look at impacts, that would be quite different from experiments that have taken place so far. Again, if MRV is included so that we look at the actual sequestration of carbon. And then if the research set a standard for what the nature of assessment would be, including the assessment of social impacts and social issues. So what should NSF be thinking about before funding? I think that NSF really needs to look at a vision or a plan for what they are doing in this area. Do they want to actually determine whether any of these ideas would work and what their impacts are? Or are they just interested in continuing to look at processes? Or do they just want to fund pieces of this, looking at modeling for MRV? Many believe that the full impact of marine carbon dioxide removal on the ocean will only be apparent at the demonstration scale, at a scale that's large enough to show us what the impacts on biology and chemistry would be. Is NSF actually prepared to fund demonstration scale? And are they prepared to fund more than the geoscience experiments, social science work on this, engineering, looking at the techniques for deployment, biology? I think that one of the big gaps in this work has been the gap of an integrated look at this. And so I think the NSF needs to be thinking about whether they are prepared to do that, or whether they are only prepared to look at pieces of this. And that's a very different way that NSF would be thinking about funding. It's really, NSF has said that they are basic research, that they look at the elements of this as opposed to taking on campaigns. What we need most is a campaign to do this, are they willing to do that? One comment we're going to hear from Matt Long about MRV challenges and modeling, but to give you an example of just what a challenge this is, There was a really interesting paper earlier this year by Abdullah and his colleagues, and they worked with the folks from the Keeling Curve research to model what would how soon the Keeling Curve would see emissions reductions. And that's where, you know, on land emission reductions on paths to deep decarbonization. And they found that even the most aggressive mitigation scenarios require 11 to 16 years to detect a signal or demonstrable progress from the noise. And 2-degree scenarios lengthen that by a decade. And that is a function of how complex it is to see the signal and separate it from the noise. And with measuring sequestration, we also have the problem that removal of carbon into the ocean results in eventually the atmosphere trying to come to equilibrium with that removal of surface CO2. And so we start to see atmospheric CO2 go into the ocean. So the separating what's happening in the ocean and the atmosphere and actually being able to detect or demonstrate progress is a huge challenge. Joellen asked us to say what we thought success would look like and what we thought failure would look like. So to me, success would be we've done the research to understand whether marine CDR makes sense at any level and can make science-informed decisions. And we've done it in a transparent and ethical way. And failure would be insufficient research resulting in the situation that profit motive, panic, or international politics of strategy are solely or mutually driving deployment. So thanks very much for the opportunity to talk to you about this.
Sorry, I know no time for clapping, but thank you, Margaret. And thank you for getting to the success failure modes. I think sometimes as scientists, we like to just do the research and not necessarily think about what the scale and context are. So I really appreciate that. Phil Boyd from the University of Tasmania. Wait. Yes, you are next. Margo, are you going to share his slides for him? Wonderful. Thank you. Go ahead, take it away, Phil. I've been waiting to hear this talk. Go. Now,
I'm going to give you the take-homes up front because we only have 5 minutes, but really the next 10 years is crucial. I can't stress that enough. Can you still hear me?
I can hear you, Phil.
Yes, I see. Sorry, I got a message. The next 10 years is crucial. And so here are the four take-homes. We have to devise a multi-stranded timeline. It has to be multi-stranded because just looking at science or technology alone aren't enough. We need law, we need regulatory frameworks, we need public perception, social license. The second point is there's a huge amount we can learn from the existing knowledge base. I'll give you some examples. I've been working in this space for 15 years now, and there really is a lot of things we can learn that we know about the Earth system science. The third thing is we need a third pillar, and that's to use large-scale proxies for CDR. These are out there. They're freebies, really, and I'll give you a couple examples of those. But the main one is while all of these are going on and we can push them along, we need concurrent capacity building because this is the billion-ton problem. We have to really massively upscale, and we don't have the personnel or the tools in sufficient number to do that at the minute. Can I have the next slide, please? So this is why we can't just have science and technology alone. Some of you may have seen what happened in the UK recently. The people tried to do a pilot study. They didn't socialize the issue. The local community used the internet and drew potentially the wrong conclusion. So science and tech alone aren't enough. We have to engage in social license and a number of other processes. Next slide, please. We have to build capacity and time is short. Mauna Loa, we're up to 424 parts per million in May. And this schematic on the left then shows you that the experimental capacity, particularly at scale, is very limited. That's where the capacity building needs to come. We also have to somehow merge these challenges of ethics, social license, adaptive governance. These things will take time. And so you can see very quickly from this schematic, we'll eat up a decade very quickly. So it's time to get busy. Next slide, please. There's lots we can learn from the existing literature. Here's a paper from a series of papers from 15 years ago, Ocean Iron Fertilization and Culture, Ocean Iron Fertilization and the Law, designing the 10,000 square kilometer ocean iron fertilization experiment. It's out there, we need to access it. Next slide, please. We need knowledge brokers as well. Here's an example from some work that was done that showed how plankton evolved to colonize the open ocean. How is that relevant? Well, we're talking about colonizing the ocean with kelp. There's a good reason only two of more than 15,000 seaweed species live offshore. They can't cut it. This paper from a couple of weeks ago shows that if we're going to grow kelp in the open ocean, we have to also add iron. That completely changes the game in terms of social license. Next slide, please. Here's another example from Bonnie Balch's work in the Gulf of Maine called ChalkX. This did a large scale addition of chalk to the ocean. They wanted to look at biooptics, but there's a lot we can learn from it with respect to what happens when we release a large amount of alkaline material into the ocean. So a lot of stuff to be done. Again, this is 20 years old. And then the final slide, please. This is about the third pillar that we need. We need to use these natural analogs. If you were to ask, can we do ocean afforestation from the Caribbean to West Africa? You'd be told no, but this has been happening for the last 10 years. This is the Great Atlantic Sargassum Belt. We assessed the CDR from this. When we propagated the upper bound and the lower bound, one will draw down carbon dioxide. The lower bound actually releases it to the atmosphere. So these are very rich data sets to tap into that can help accompany the experimentation work we need to do that Margaret referred to, but also the planetary scale modeling. Another example then of these enclosed seas where geochemical weathering is also sort of carrying out an ocean alkalinity enhancement in a closed system like the Black Sea. What would success look like? A multi-stranded decadal plan. Failure, I'm afraid, is not an option. We need to get busy. Thank you.
Wonderful, Phil. Fantastic. And we're going to hold questions till the end here. Sarah Cooley is going to talk to us next. Sarah, we'll give you a 1 minute warning, but fantastic, Phil. Thank you.
Thanks, Joelle, and hi, everybody. Thanks so much to the panel for putting together this really interesting seminar. And I really want to acknowledge the speakers that came before me, especially on Tuesday. So much great content was shared then as well. And I think it's all going to be a really interesting food for thought. So I'm Sarah Cooley. I'm Director of Climate Science at Ocean Conservancy. We're a nonprofit. We think a lot about implementation of marine activities. And because so little is known about ocean carbon dioxide removal, we think that a highly coordinated body of publicly supported multidisciplinary research is needed to understand all of these approaches. But as I'll discuss, research on ocean carbon dioxide removal requires some elements that haven't been strong themes in prior ocean research. So ocean-based carbon dioxide removal is a new technology. Next slide, please. There's two ways of imagining new technology. On the left, we have a techno-economic view of a flying car. Does this flying car work? How much does it cost? Will construction costs come down when we scale up? On the right is the socio-technical point of view, where you're thinking about a new technology in context of other existing activities, rules and regulations, people's perceptions, their goals, their fears, their appetite for risks and benefits. And so when it comes to ocean carbon dioxide removal, I've been thinking about it from this socio-technical view. Next slide, please. As you really have heard already, there are so many more questions than answers right now about ocean carbon dioxide removal research. But it's becoming really clear that how we do the research is just as important as what we research. And that's something that individual research teams can't really address well, but a coordinated initiative like one run at a National Science Foundation would be in a better position to do this. So for example, when we think about how to do inclusive iterative research, you can check the box by asking everyone with an ocean interest for input and by including workforce development goals. But the next generation of inclusive iterative research needs to also consider things like who's calling for this research or technology? How do they engage with their surroundings? What's the relationship of dominant groups with nature? How do ocean CDR approaches individually or collectively support particular communities' achievement of the ocean they want in the future? So I want to underline how important social science research is to answer these questions about different perspectives and values and futures. Cross-directorate linkages would be essential here. Thinking about iterative research, we can learn a lot from other non-marine areas of tech development, borrowing from engineering and other sciences to implement iterative rounds of development, testing, and scaling and consultation. Again, cross-directorate linkages. So when we think about how research differs from implementation, there's a lot of logistical and verification challenges. Some folks have mentioned the questions of intent and liability and incentives, and there are a number of steps forward. Several projects are drafting research codes of conduct right now, but it's very inefficient to let 1,000 flowers bloom and let natural selection of these ideas take their place. So right now, the ocean CDR community is extremely research heavy. Most information creators follow a Western science approach. And, you know, while that's sort of traditional approach to the National Science Foundation, it's a liability if we need ocean CDR research to provide decision-relevant information. Most information users are not involved right now, and their questions are not being answered yet by the research. So in each of these questions, how we do the research or how it's framed can't be taken on by these individual teams. Next slide, please. I've made a case for a cross-directorate initiative for both carbon removal and for ocean carbon removal. Lessons learned from land can apply to ocean issues. Social science, ethical research applies to ocean issues and carbon removal too. Material science can aid in carbon capture. Engineering offers insights on process and technology, let alone logistics and major infrastructure. Verification is really a computer science question as much as it is an ocean question. The list goes on. So next slide, please. The context in which National Science Foundation operates is also important. NSF is already engaged in interagency working groups and Ocean Science Technology Subcommittee, and it's also tightly coordinated with internationally acting agencies. Next slide, please. I will leave you with the idea that winning really is similar to something that Margaret said, where it's inclusive, place-conscious research that is transparent and it vets these approaches for their outcomes regarding the environment, the economy, carbon cycle, society, and for governance. The losing view is basically rushed, opaque, highly privatized research that champions specific CDR approaches as best picks and justified by limited evidence that feeds an unjust credit system and could carry serious risks for people in the ocean. National Science Foundation may never support purely curiosity-driven research on ocean CDR, but NSF can play a leveling or mediating role on use-inspired research. NSF can help research outcomes be more equitable by ensuring that multiple ways of knowing are incorporated into this research and the broadest possible disciplines, broadest possible array of disciplines are included and effective knowledge transfer happens among expert areas. I'll stop there.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Wonderful. And way to stick to time. That was really, I appreciate you.
It was a close shave.
Right in. So next we are going to hear from John Dunn, one of my all-time favorite Earth system modelers and innovators, and from GFDL and NOAA. Take it away, John.
Yeah, thanks a lot, John. Next slide. So I'd like to begin with a story that I think describes our current CO2 mitigation strategy of Hercules' fifth labor, the Augean stables. Every night, the cowherds, goatherds, and shepherds drove thousands of animals to King Augeas' stables. The largest in Greece, the stables had never before been cleaned. Eurystheus ordered Hercules to clean up the stables in a single day. To complete the task, Hercules directed his great strength not to lift out the dung, a truly arduous task, but rather to tear an opening in the wall of the stables. Then he made another opening in the wall of the opposite side of the yard. Next, he dug wide trenches to two rivers which flowed nearby. The rivers rushed through the stables, flushing them out, and gave birth to the adage, the solution to pollution is dilution, which is what the oceans and are taking up now. Next. So three big challenges to get past the pure dilution solution is the need, as been discussed by Philip already, avoid results like the London Convention on Iron, where the iron fertilization were associated with pollution concerns and really put a great chill on the scientific engagement on the topic. The need for engagement, transparency, inclusiveness, and deliberative and robust science is key. The second challenge is the need to build science capacity of oceanographers fluent not only with the basic science with the expectation of getting careers in academia or government, but those embracing the societal, political, legal context to enable solutions-oriented and corporate and non-governmental organization workforce. And then finally, the logistics that tracking purposeful changes to ocean carbon cycle would be very daunting. This and require robust measuring, monitoring, reporting, and verification, which in my view would require both measurements and applications at choke points, such as rivers and channels, that can be robustly characterized and modeled and measured, and as well as inclusion of globally consistent tracer release protocols across direct CO2 injection, alkalinization, and iron fertilization activities. Next. So for this first one, on the history that we've had with exploring iron fertilization, Philip pointed me to this quote of concerned about the potential widespread, long-lasting, or severe impacts on the marine environment of the placement of matter from unregulated iron fertilization activities and other proposed marine geoengineering techniques, and determined to put in place science-based, global, transparent, and effective control and regulatory mechanism for such activities. It's important to get ahead on this so that we can avoid panic. Next. So in terms of the ocean solutions workforce, there was a really great Ocean Vision Summit where Margaret and Susan Lozier gave very inspiring talks about how the ocean workforce needs to be expanded. And I'll point you to that and let you investigate on your own. Next. And finally, with this, the measuring, monitoring, reporting, verification aspects, there's critical questions like, can the change be measured over natural variability? As Margaret pointed to, this may take a decade or more. At scale, is that technology ready, available, accessible, and reproducible across potential sites and across the global ocean? And can durability be confidently assessed? Can ecosystem consequences be detected and attributed? And the main point is that answering these questions requires extensive and ongoing observation and modeling capabilities. Next. So, you know, winning and losing, this is starting probably to look familiar. To what winning looks like, in my view, is implementation of MCDR solutions that leverage ecological enhancement, restoring productivity, biomass, wetlands, seagrasses, and reducing eutrophication. Whereas losing, it would involve promotion of enhanced fossil fuel use with non-durable and polluting MCDR, such as direct CO2 injection in the Gulf of Mexico, which has been proposed, and in which case it, we might see impacts on corals and integrated marine systems, and only be able to detect the consequences after the impacts have been realized. And that's all I had. Hopefully I'm on time.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Thank you, John. Yeah, I worry about that too. I do. Non-durable and polluting. Mm. And Matt Long is going to be our next speaker from the National Center for Atmospheric Research. Thank you, Matt.
Great. Thanks for inviting me to speak today. I really appreciate everything that's been said thus far in this session. I'm going to talk about my perspective on orienting research towards action in the context of this really critical moment in history. I think I concur with Phil Boyd's assessment about the next decade. I think as a backdrop for this, it's just useful to point out that the quantity of CO2 removal required over the next century is a really large number, essentially equivalent to doubling the ocean sink by 2050. And then by the end of the century, we need to have CO2 removal rate that's approximately double the ocean sink in total. Right now, one of the things that's going on is this massive flood of investment into the CDR space. And I've illustrated that here with just a collection of the companies that I'm aware of and engaged with. In order for market mechanisms to really address the climate crisis by deploying ocean CDR, there's a requirement for robust quantification. And this is really the pivotal decade. To enable this industry to scale, we have to move fast, and we have to set the trajectory appropriately so that science is at the forefront of leading this initiative. This is a really daunting problem. This plot illustrates the northern extratropical land flux as inferred from a collection of inversion models. And essentially the point here is that the uncertainty has not really changed over the past three decades. To illustrate the magnitude of this uncertainty, I've included a bar on the right there that shows the 2030 commitment under the Paris Accord. So the implication here is that uncertainty in the carbon cycle projects onto our ability to verify the function of international agreements for climate change mitigation. The situation in the ocean is comparable. Here's a similar plot showing the global integral air sea flux. I think research is really required to assess gating criteria in the context of deploying CDR. And I've listed three of those here. This is perhaps an incomplete list, but we really need to understand the ecological safety before beginning to deploy things at scale. It doesn't necessarily preclude field trials, but the risk of negative environmental consequences has to be assessed and valued in the context of the alternatives. We need to understand net negativity. And I think that across the collection of proposed CDR approaches, it's not clear a priori that all of them will yield net carbon removal. And then finally, verifiability, even in principle, we have to be able to imagine that there is a path towards scientifically rigorous and transparent methods for verification. Challenges to quantifying ocean CDR are substantial. The baselines are complicated. CO2 equilibration is slow, and so there's large spatiotemporal scales. The signal-to-noise ratios are highly unfavorable. And then we don't fully understand how ecosystems will respond, as been mentioned by several speakers so far. One of the things that we've been thinking about a lot is the idea that we need to basically adapt tools that have been developed in the Earth system modeling community towards bespoke systems for verification. Given the challenges associated with the ocean as a turbulent fluid and the complex ecosystem dynamics of that system, it's inconceivable that models will not have a fundamental role to play, but our current models are not really fit for purpose. And so we see a role for adapting these systems towards more fit for purpose decision support frameworks. In the context of building these systems, I believe that we need to instantiate end-to-end prototypes and then deploy those prototypes in the context of both field trials and intensive observational arrays so as to test and verify their fidelity and leverage those systems to develop market quality methods for MRV. We need to understand that in the context of the climate crisis, we are not conducting research in abstract, but to produce MRV systems, but we want to make sure that MRV systems are robust, but pragmatic. And so here's a list of potential criteria that would define an acceptable MRV framework. I'll just highlight a couple here. Good enough means that the systems are scientifically credible and transparent. They return estimates of net carbon removal and durability, but they also return estimates of uncertainty, which is critical. And then the last one, the systems are getting better. We need to instantiate systems that can evolve and improve as the state of knowledge improves. Finally, just a note about the institutional frameworks that can invoke this kind of system. One of the things I've been involved in exploring is this idea of a focused research organization that sits outside the traditional sectors of the traditional commercial sectors or government-funded research, but is nonprofit, but is capable of moving fast like a startup company, and really aims to change the trajectory of the industry by developing some public infrastructure around MRV frameworks. The initiative I'm working on is called Seaworthy, and we're hoping to launch in the next month.
Fantastic. Thank you, Matt. Really appreciate the input. This is one of those places that is really growing and changing. So it was fantastic to have you participate today. I really appreciate it. Romani, you are up next. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me turn my camera on here. Well, it's always hard to be the last person on a panel, but it's especially hard today because we've had such stellar presentations from everyone else. But I'm happy to be here. My name is Romani Webb. I am based at the Sabin Center for Climate Change Law at Columbia Law School. So I am a lawyer by training, and some of you might be wondering what a lawyer is doing on this panel with expert scientists talking about researching ocean CDR. And I guess the answer, or my answer, Jolie might have a different one. My answer is that, you know, legal considerations are going to have a huge bearing on whether, when, where, and how we can actually do research into ocean carbon dioxide removal, and then how we think about scaling up from research to deployment if we get there. So we've already heard today that there's a huge need for research in this space. There's lots of unanswered scientific and other questions about how well different ocean CDR techniques work, what the risks and benefits they offer are. We are starting to see some government funding for research, particularly in Europe, but also in Asia and here in the US. There are some research programs that are being funded. There are a number of bills currently before Congress that would allocate significantly more funding for research in these fields. At the same time, as we're seeing this push to advance government-funded research, we're also seeing, as Matt just noted, a huge amount of private sector interest in this field, this growing proliferation of startups here in the US that are being established to develop and ultimately commercialize these CDR techniques, and have been hugely successful in raising private dollars to do that. So we're at this really interesting inflection point, I think, where on the one hand, there is a recognition that we need more research, that we don't yet have the information we need to fully assess these techniques and make decisions about their deployment. But on the other hand, we're seeing all of this corporate activity that is really premised on the assumption that these things work and can be deployed at scale. And so in that context, I would argue that effective governance is hugely important to ensure that ocean CDR research happens in a safe and responsible way that maximizes benefits and minimizes risks to the environment and communities. And I would argue that our existing legal frameworks are not particularly well suited to do that. You know, there is a huge amount of legal uncertainty and complexity surrounding ocean CDR. Part of the reason for that is that we're talking about activities taking place in the ocean, which is, of course, a shared resource. There is a large body of international law that governs ocean-based activities. You know, countries have agreed to numerous bilateral and multilateral agreements that deal with things like ocean access, pollution control, resource management, et cetera. None of those agreements were designed specifically to regulate ocean CDR. In fact, currently, there is not a single legally binding international agreement that is in force that deals specifically with ocean CDR. But a lot of these general agreements we have governing ocean-based activities could apply to or have implications for ocean CDR. And there have at various times over the last three decades or so been attempts to sort of fit ocean CDR into these existing agreements. So John already spoke about the discussions around ocean fertilization under the London Convention and Protocol. Similarly, other parties to other international agreements have adopted decisions and resolutions that deal with ocean CDR generally or geoengineering more broadly. This is one example from the Convention on Biological Diversity. But there's lots of unanswered questions about exactly how these will work and how they will be operationalized. Similarly, here in the US, there is also a huge amount of uncertainty about the domestic laws that will apply to ocean CDR. So this table, which I took from the National Academies report, shows some of the key federal environmental laws that could apply to different types of ocean CDR activities in different locations. And the details here don't matter so much as the number of potentially applicable laws. It's a really complicated legal framework. And this is just the federal laws. In some cases, ocean CDR projects may be also subject to state law, to local law, and to tribal law. And so my organization, the Sabin Center, did a sort of deep dive into how these laws might apply to ocean CDR. And we found that many of them impose duplicative and sometimes even conflicting permit and other requirements that could make it really difficult to move forward with certain research projects. At the same time, there are also some key gaps and shortcomings in these laws that mean that they might not adequately address the unique risks posed by ocean CDR research, and they might create opportunities for so-called rogue actors to move forward with projects that don't have appropriate safeguards in place. So there is a real need for more coordination and collaboration between government agencies to make sure that we're effectively regulating these activities. And I think, as Sarah alluded to, the NSF is really well placed to facilitate some of that coordination. I also just want to note, as others have, because of these gaps in the legal frameworks, there have been several attempts to develop codes of conduct and best practice guides for different ocean CDR activities. Some of them are still being developed. Some of them have already been put in place. This is not a perfect substitute for effective governance, but it is better than nothing. And so there is, again, a real role for organizations like NSF that are supporting research or participating in research to, for example, insist on compliance with things like this as a bare minimum to fill some of those gaps in the legal framework. So I will leave it there and back to Joellen.
Fantastic. Fantastic. And yes, we obviously did need a lawyer to come. this is not a research area that can be cleanly separated from humans. It just can't. we're working in a framework and on a scale, or we would like to be working on a scale where it would actually impact climate. The whole point of this entire workshop is climate intervention. So I'm going to kick off with a question for all of the panelists. We have, let's see, I'm seeing 23 minutes to go. So we'll have plenty of time for questions, but we had winning and losing with CDR research. What I'd like to ask is, what would it take? What could NSF do today, now, to help us if a major state or rogue actor started a major implementation of what they're calling CDR? This could be river outflow. This could be major tankers full of something being, you know, iron solution or other being dumped. Could we see it? What would it look like? Would we know what the impacts are? What could NSF, what kind of research should the NSF be funding if this is part of our future? I know you've all read the book, you know, where a state in the future says, I'm going to immediately start with climate intervention because I don't want my people to die of heat waves. So I just want to take the sci-fi question right out of the gate. What should NSF be doing with the potential for a country or non-state actor to decide to do this? Because I was reading the language in the law there that Romani put up, and it said if a hazard or impact could be shown, right, demonstrated. And I wondered how much could we do before we hit that threshold? And even if we did, what would be the enforcement mechanism on the high seas? So why don't we start with Margaret, and then we'll go to Phil right after.
Well, I think it depends on scale. So we have had a rogue actor who has done two deployments of iron fertilization. It was at small enough scale that no one knew about it until he announced that he had done it. Anything that was larger scale that involves something that results in additional productivity, like artificial upwelling, nutrient fertilization, that was larger scale, we'll see in satellites. I think the issue is that clause that you read from the law is key, that says that we can demonstrate that it is harmful. And of course, the issue is that there would be nobody out there measuring harmful effects. So we would be arguing from theory that this is harmful. And that's a real problem. And I think that I don't know that NSF is the appropriate agency to step into this. NOAA,
I don't know. Vannevar Bush would say they are. They're funded on service to the nation post-war, right? As a way to use those technologies. I'm just saying, I'm not willing.
No, I mean, in terms of intervening with a rogue actor, NOAA's the one who has lawyers, but when rogue actors have had no negative consequence, there's a problem. And I think that the U.S. in general needs to step in and say, if you've done this without some kind of, consultation and public, the public is aware of it, that we won't accept it and there'll be consequences. That I know, Roman, that's very wishy-washy, isn't it? But you could probably say what the legal frame would be. But I think that it is important for us to try to exclude rogue actors.
Phil, you were next.
Yes, I think we learned on Tuesday with the solar radiation management that given that we only have one atmosphere and given the much smaller costs involved, that the rogue actor issue is probably more likely to happen for SRM rather than CDR. As Margaret mentioned, it could be conspicuous if it was biological, you could spot it from satellite. If it was with carbon, as both Margaret and Matt pointed out, we wouldn't find it. But as I say, I think just given the cost of CDR and the timescales involved, I think that's more of an issue for SRM.
Okay, John?
So we have a couple of examples from Deepwater Horizon and Fukushima, where in both cases we were able to enter the exclusive economic zone to take measurements. In the Deepwater Horizon because it was ours, and in Fukushima because we had permission from the Japanese government. In the latter case, the Navy played a critical role in that. But without a permission in the exclusive economic zone, there's no potential to collect data. So if that is the case, then I think we are limited to the 300 kilometer line of maybe Romani can help with that legal aspect. But I think deployment of like sail drones and biogeochemical Argo, sort of along the boundary would I think kind of be the only option in that case.
Sarah?
I've got an element to add. One of the things that I'm hearing now is that we have elected leaders in this country who find the proposals of essentially rogue actors pretty appealing. Hey, let's do this soon because it sounds like a great idea and you're selling me something that sounds great. I think one way that NSF is positioned today to help inform that conversation is NSF has like quick access to some of the top experts in this topic about where the uncertainties lie, where the risks lie. And the NSF is in a position to actually help broker educational connections between the experts and the policymakers. Now, I always, tell scientific audiences, like, sadly, no policymaker ever made a decision purely on science. But NSF is in a position to help broker a closer connection from the evidence, no matter how embryonic our evidence is today, to the people who need it. And I know that has not been an NSF's favorite spot to operate in, because there's always been this hesitancy to be like, scientists, we need to be objective. But scientists also need to be information brokers. And no matter how, curiosity driven any of the science on this topic, or how many of any of those research outcomes, however much that's, especially curiosity driven, all of that information is going to get used by someone in an application. And I think it's important for NSF to kind of like come to grips with that reality and help start brokering those relationships for better information transfer to support that evidence-based decision-making.
We are guests today, of course, of the National Academy of Science, who has a charter signed by Abraham Lincoln to provide advice on science and technology policy to the US government. So they are, partnering now. Yeah. I totally recognize partnering with NSF to try and get more clarity on these issues. However, I do worry that, like Phil said, we're not moving fast enough. This is just not coming together quickly enough. And I worry flat that NSF has a record low investment now as a percentage of their portfolio in ocean science. And this is grievous. That 72% of the Earth's surface, 93% of the top of the atmosphere energy imbalance, and one out of four carbon molecules out of anybody's tailpipe anywhere in the world goes in the ocean. And it is at a record low investment in ocean science right now at NSF. They are flat not investing in this area, not just not CDR, but I mean, basic ocean understanding is being neglected relative to other areas in the middle of a massive climate crisis. I find that problematic. And I'll let Matt answer. Sorry. Small editorial. Go, Matt.
Thanks, Joellen. I think maybe the rogue actor question is a little bit of a red herring, but it speaks broadly to what I think is a requirement that we need frameworks for detection and attribution. That's what MRV is. And those will rely on continued and increased investment in backbone observing networks coupled with numerical models that are doing state estimation and capacities to deploy bespoke observational networks around early field trials and then subsequently deployments, and the modeling infrastructure that can be tailored to address those experiments and provide kind of decision support frameworks over time. And so, all that stuff is just a hugely complicated space. It's situated in the context of these long standing uncertainties in the global carbon budget, in the ocean and the terrestrial system as well. And I think, there really needs to just be a paradigm shift in the context of our intention to do research, not just for, advancing understanding, but really in the context of supporting decisions. And so the rogue actor thing is a decision in that space, but I wouldn't put it at the top of the list.
I worry simply because I got that email, and probably all of you on this call got the same email this morning from our IOCCP colleagues saying that SOCAT, which is our global, data packet, data product based on the surface PCO2 on underway PCO2 primarily. They are potentially shutting down their data group and don't have ongoing funding, period. And I find that the day we're having our climate interventions panel to say that we are giving up on potentially because of a lack of funding, the data products that we use in order to see the carbon flux into the ocean, I find it, and of course, GOBGC are, the US NSF funded global array of biogeochemical floats has three more years of funding and has already been told that there isn't a re-up at NSF through the mid-scale research infrastructure program because they don't do re-ups. So I'm looking at this going, okay, if these are one-offs, then we're not speaking loud enough. And I do understand why everybody says, oceanography is very important. I'm like, yes, yes, it is. And then they say, well, how many of you are there? And I'm like, well, AGU tells us that there's roughly 6,000 PhD level oceanographers in the world, roughly 60,000 meteorologists and 600,000 geologists. So when we think about a thin blue line, this is about the thinnest blue line I could imagine. And I love the fact that so many of our speakers actually talked about the workforce, the fact that it takes 10 years to build an oceanographer. And if you tell me tomorrow we need 500, I have no idea how we would do that because we are not scaled to produce that kind of education in rapid form. So even if we wanted to have more people to do that lovely modeling that you would like to do, I don't know, have you been, like me, you've probably been hiring postdocs and other young people to do modeling recently. Not an easy task, is it? Because it is like musical chairs around here. There are not enough butts for all of the seats that we would like to provide to do this next research. So I'm concerned. I say rogue actor partly because it's already happened, but partly also because I think it's scaling and the interest is scaling and the money is scaling. So Romani, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I mean, I think that a lot of good points have already been made. I just wanted to flag a couple of things. I think Sarah's point about educating policymakers is absolutely key and cannot be overstated the importance of doing that, not just for the NSF, but for the National Academies and other groups like it. I also think, as I sort of alluded to in my opening remarks, like within the sort of governance frameworks, there's a lot of fragmentation. And that, I think, does create additional opportunities for, not necessarily rogue actors, but for people to skirt the minimum requirements that we have. You think about, we have these overlapping levels of layers of international law, US federal law, state law, local law. And, an operator might comply with the state law, but not notify federal agencies about what it's doing. So there's these opportunities for gaps. And so there's a real need for better coordination across both, within the federal government, but then also between the federal government and other levels. The final point I wanted to make comes back to something Margaret said, which is, like, I think there is a immense need for us to differentiate to the extent we can between the good and bad actors in this space. What does a good research project look like? Because if we do see more of these sort of quote unquote rogue actors or people who are trying to skirt the requirements, there is a real risk that that affects sort of social perceptions of every piece of Ocean CDR research. And we really need to think about ways to differentiate the sort of good research from the bad and the responsible research from the irresponsible research.
Wonderful. Sarah.
If I may, I want to underline this question about, who benefits. Joelle, in your comments about, who's paying for this and how do we develop a workforce? One of the things that I listed in my, what does failure look like slide is, failure to me looks like increasing privatization of any of these activities. It includes, you can't really have land grab, but ocean grabs, to kind of privatize this global ocean, and this common good. And I think that's one thing that we need to be cognizant of, that publicly funded efforts are much more in line with an increasingly equitable and just approach to ocean governance and ocean management. We have come so far in terms of doing better on including populations in making decisions about ocean spaces. Romani can tell you chapter and verse all of the complicated patchwork of governance we have, but at the end of the day, it's about getting people to, weigh in on what they see the ocean means to them. And, the converse of that is if we have this sort of push towards privatization and people kind of getting theirs and then doing it through private means. And that is actually counter to the justice accomplishments that we've begun to make on inclusive ocean governance. So hence my ranting about social science inclusion and things like that, too.
You worry about a gold rush of carbon credits where potentially the implementation is a negative. I mean, they're for many different reasons, and that we basically have to bring our people with us. We have to bring all our people with us. And that means, starting with the young, but getting all the way to our legislators at their age. And remember, it's happening so fast. I'm always reminded that my parents, not even me, I didn't have climate science in my curriculum through high school. None of that was covered, ever. I had geo classes. I did not have anything to do with our climate or habitable planet, zero. And now we require it at our literacy standards for the ocean, which we just updated in Arizona, which is landlocked. So I appreciate that we have to bring everybody with us, and that given how small we are and how many they are, and what our stewardship responsibility is, I mean, it's enormous. It literally and figuratively enormous. And I don't know how to scale that. I don't know of another field with this big a mismatch between the coalition of the willing and the actual implementation. But people are now waking up to the fact that their oceans matter, that they're important to all of us, every last person on planet ocean, and that major changes are underway. And I think in many ways, it just scares people. It was once upon a time, the great vasty deep was something that we only told stories to our kids about and fairy tales. And only very few of us actually visited or spent any time, real time, grappling with. And now here we are in this tiny little community trying to tell these quantitative, real data stories to the people. And we're not even sure they're ready to hear us. And this is a profound challenge. And I wonder if the NSF understands just what an uphill battle we've got in front of us. I see Margaret and then Matt. Margaret.
Yes, I agree that, Joellen, that it's hard to understand how NSF would take it on. I think the other thing is that everything that we've discussed here really points to having to have an organized campaign approach to looking at these issues. And that's not something that NSF does very well. And it's also this issue, as everybody has talked about with the ethical principles, guiding principles, that's something that NIH has confronted, first with recombinant DNA, then with human subject research. And NSF, other than, you know, social science and whatnot, doesn't work on that. And the idea that it has to be such a comprehensive experiment to understand what's going on. You know, we haven't had big campaigns like that in the ocean for a couple of decades. And I think it's going to be a real challenge for NSF to think about doing this and to wrap its mind around approaching this as, you know, doing something that is working toward a big answer and a big community effort.
I wish I had little slogans that would work, like Smokey the Bear on land. You could say Smokey the Bear says, just don't burn it. I mean, sure, because that would work for fossil fuels. And in the ocean, we used to have things like loose lips sink ships. But how do we tell them what the potential outcome here is? What I worry about is what I think it was Matt who said, that what happens when we stop, when we bend the curve and the ocean compensates hard. I mean, these are predictable. We know that it's going to happen. And yet I think folks are not ready. Not ready for the role the ocean's about to play in their lives. And here comes El Nino. So Matt?
I'd just like to say a few words, partially in response to Sarah and also some things that Margaret said in her talk. I think it's worth thinking about, you know, what the institutions, the social institutions are that need to come together to invoke CDR as a solution to as a solution to the climate crisis. And I've spent most of my career, you know, in the research sector, but recently engaged quite extensively with private companies. And I have to say, I'm very inspired by the action-oriented perspective of those companies. But as Margaret said, they do not have, as individual companies, the resources to confront the major challenges, with regard to the complexity of the scientific issues and, you know, the magnitude of the research infrastructure investment necessary to kind of pin down the fluxes of interest to an acceptable degree of uncertainty. And so I really think that the framework for public investment needs to consider the research and the research infrastructure necessary to underpin a large new sector, economic sector. And if thinking about it that way presents some interesting opportunities for empowering the private sector, leveraging that that action-oriented perspective, but ensuring that science is at the forefront of leading those initiatives. And I just think that perspective is really important and can provide a framework to guide investment.
I think that's a fantastic, fantastic perspective. The idea that if we add the MRV, the agency level, government level infrastructure to observe and monitor, predict, and that then responsible investment and growth in our companies to actually respond to this, but then enable, you know, let the thousand flowers bloom within this context so that we can both be sure that it's being done well and that it's effective. And you had that nice list. I really appreciated that. That is fantastic. I want to do a little tiny lightning round before we wrap up. Okay, I'm going to ask a horrible question. You don't have to answer, but I'm going to hit everybody. What's your favorite ocean CDR strategy right now? I mean, technology slash implementation. And you can refuse to answer, or, you know, if you have a favorite, I'd love to hear it. Margaret, and then Phil. Sorry,
I'm not going to answer it because I think that a critical piece, you know, aside from the MRV point of view and whatnot that's missing, is also that that, you know, systems analysis. We're all talking about, you know, does it work? And, you know, what happens in the ocean? But a big piece is, what is the cost of scaling any of this to the level that it actually impacts the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere? And that sort of life cycle systems analysis is also utterly missing.
Right. Phil, you had other words to say.
It has to be chemically based sequestration. The underlying principles are sound. The number of potential side effects and risks are lower than elsewhere. Underestimate it will still be very difficult. But I think we have to go down that pathway. I think there's a
I too am a fan, a big fan. That actually would be my favorite too. I'll just confess. Sarah, you're next on my screen. Sorry.
All right. I'd have to say my favorite methods are the ones that verifiably remove carbon and have zero or positive ecosystem and social effects. So that is basically saying I am staying tuned because I think there's a ton to learn and we just don't know yet.
Sorry. Yeah, I was going to say, you know, ecosystem recovery, but I think that a lot more are necessary because I don't think ecosystem recovery is going to do it.
All right. Matt?
I'll just draw the distinction between biotic and abiotic, predominantly abiotic methods, and refer back to my criterion, gating criterion, the notion of quantifiable and sort of an ability to value ecosystem impacts. Net negativity, which I cannot say a priori some of the biotic techniques achieve at this point, and verifiability. And so for me, what that suggests is that the proposed approaches stratify in the context of research timelines necessary to demonstrate that we can meet those criteria and that the science underpinning the deployment is robust. So that perspective is somewhat agnostic, but you know, with respect to favoritism, but nuanced in the sense that I'm presenting, you know, criterion for deployment.
Fantastic. And Romani, you're a lawyer, but we'll let you have a whack.
You'll let Go me ahead. Pick. I tend to agree with Matt. You know, I think that we'll need a portfolio of approaches. That much is clear. And I agree with Matt's sort of, we need these criteria to assess different approaches by which, but I would add that we should really also be thinking about the social implications of these different activities, not just the ecological, which are hugely important. But, you know, if you think about something like seaweed cultivation, it could have huge benefits for coastal communities, particularly in low-income countries. It could have huge sort of gender benefits because a lot of seaweed cultivation in the developing world is done by women. You know, we need to be thinking about the full gamut, not just the carbon, not just the ecosystem, but the social as well.
A full win-win-win. That's what we're going for here. I like it. I like it a lot. Okay, we've reached time. Am I right, Jim? I think we've come to the end of our panel. I so appreciate each and every one of you. It is extraordinary to be in the presence of such amazing scholars. Thank you for being here today. I appreciate all of your contributions and courage. We have a huge row to hoe here, and I'm so glad you're here with us in the trenches. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, here we go. Hello, everyone. We are going to get started with our last session. I am Sonali McDermott at NYU's Department of Environmental Studies. And welcome to the crux of this particular workshop, session 5, the role of the National Science Foundation, what everyone is itching to talk about. And so I think this is going to be a really engaging and exciting and forward-looking session. And so following from our previous sessions and the hearty discussion that Joellen just led, this session is intended to specifically identify key considerations and needs for the National Science Foundation, as well as actionable next steps as we move a step closer towards federal sponsorship of research on climate intervention. Now, as we begin this session, I'll remind everyone again that we do so under the Earth System Sciences Research Framework described in the recent National Academies reports, which calls for explicit and considered integration of the natural and social sciences and strives towards convergent research goals and approaches. Several of our panelists on this upcoming panel and across the workshop have actually had much experience with NSF's new push in areas of convergent research and in developing the Earth System Sciences approaches that we are using in this workshop. And we'll seek to synthesize those insights here. Now, we've already heard about a range of topics, recommendations, suggestions, thoughts about what NSF should do. And so I'm going to try to steer this session to be able to cover as much of that as possible between our speakers' comments and the Q&A afterwards. And so what I'll do right here is just seed some broad areas in advance, and we can follow up on these in question form a little bit later. And our speakers will obviously speak to some of these comments as well. So what are important elements and expectations of climate intervention research from proposal development to the review process to post-award evaluation processes, particularly with respect to interdisciplinarity, impact, and research that's considered use-oriented or perhaps implementation-focused? How should we think about the design of climate intervention solicitations within and across NSF programs and directorates, including how do we handle those focused on technological advancement, particularly with private partnerships? How should NSF obligate climate intervention proposals and proposers to explicitly include ethical considerations? And what are all the ways that governance of the research or more broadly should feature in supported work? And how do we think about the inclusion and funding of diverse partners, particularly those outside the United States, related to representation and the equity concerns that we've discussed on previous panels? And there's so much more to discuss here. And so I encourage everyone to, everyone should feel welcome to input questions for those of us on Zoom in the chat, and for those of you joining us virtually elsewhere on Slido. The prior panelists and sessions have done a wonderful job of teeing up this conversation. And overall, our aim is to distill from these previous sessions, raise new points, and try to consolidate our thoughts and considerations into guidance and, where possible, recommendations to the NSF as they think about climate intervention research and that we can incorporate into our reports. So without further ado, I would now like to introduce our keynote, which will be co-presented by Lynn Badia and John Balkins from Colorado State University. And John, I can see your slides going up. So you have the floor virtually. So please take it away, John, and I will give you a 2-minute heads up.
Thanks, Sonali. And thanks everyone for being here. I'm here with Lynn Badia from Colorado State University. We are two transdisciplinary scientists who are here mostly to complain about how hard it is to do this type of work. We want to talk about kind of our experience with transdisciplinary science, why we think it's harder, more expensive, and more prone to failure, and yet why we're here to tell you we still need to try to improve upon it and to do it, especially in the realm of climate intervention. I thought it would be useful to begin by talking about how we became transdisciplinary. And the theme you will see here for myself and Lynn is that this is a decadal process. This is not a weekend workshop process. This is not I went to a conference for 4 days and came back transdisciplinary. And I think, you know, looking at this kind of confusing slide, the point here is that I started at an engineering program in civil engineering. I moved actually to a school of public health that is one of the only two schools of public health in the country that have engineering departments. And I worked on aerosols and exposure sciences and then physical chemistry and fluids for my PhD. When I got to Colorado State, this is really when I started to get into transdisciplinary. I was in a college of veterinary medicine and biomedical sciences working with a lot of health scientists. And so I quickly realized that, to do the kind of research that would be successful at CSU, I needed more training. And I got funded by the National Institutes of Health on what's called a K award. It's very analogous to an NSF career award. So I'm sure many of you are familiar with that. But the point I want to make here is that the K awards in NIH require training. They require you to actually grow either within your own discipline or into new disciplines. And in my career award was to learn things like physiology, cell and molecular biology, and lung toxicology. What's also interesting is that my training actually didn't happen at the NIH. It happened at the Environmental Protection Agency. And this is kind of very common with a transdisciplinary journey, is that you find yourself kind of in all of these black sheep environments where you're the first person trying to do this, and a new model has to be created for each kind of journey. I'll just conclude, you know, now I'm a professor of mechanical engineering, having never studied mechanical engineering as part of my career. But what I've been able to do now is really combine engineering and public health together through this journey. It took about 10 years from post-PhD until, you know, my transition into mechanical engineering and doing engineering for public health. Now, you might ask, so what? You know, what does this get you? Well, I now work at really interesting interfaces with my research. So at the top, I help lead clinical trials, not on drugs, but on clean energy and renewable energy systems, to look at how those energy systems, when introduced into a setting, might improve people's health, right? We also do research, typical mechanical engineering research, but we apply it to asthmatic kids so that their pediatricians can better manage their disease. And of course, if you're anyone who's studied aerosols and public health in the last decade, we spent a lot of time over the last 3 years looking at the interface of aerosols and infectious disease transmission, right? So I never thought I'd be going into COVID isolation wards trying to measure airborne COVID-19 with, you know, new aerosol sampling technology, or having people from the Met Opera sing in a controlled human exposure chamber to measure their aerosol release when talking and singing, to look at whether or not the performing arts was a reasonable vector for COVID-19 transmission. So I think, you know, what's really interesting about this transdisciplinary journey is that it really did allow me to work at new interfaces where I think there just wasn't a lot of science previously. I'll turn it over to Lynn for her journey.
Hi, thanks, John. Can you all hear me okay?
You sound great.
Okay, great. Thanks. I just first wanted to thank the organizers for the invitation to participate and for organizing such a rich series of panel discussions. And so my sort of opening comment is really to sort of mimic the sort of ad hoc and additional training that is needed to end up in the research spaces that I've ended up in at CSU. And so you can see that I've had a very interdisciplinary training in history, philosophy of science, and cultural studies, and I now work in these emerging fields of environmental humanities and energy humanities. And much of the training that I needed to actually work collaboratively with scientists didn't happen until the postdoc stage, and then actually with the practice of working with scientists at CSU. And so the reason to introduce ourselves in this way is really to highlight that our current institutional structures don't always provide a straightforward path for doing the kind of transdisciplinary research that has been described in this workshop. So given the complexity of climate intervention research, which we can describe with the language of complex natural social systems or wicked problems, or post-normal science, I think there's growing consensus that this research is really essential rather than additive to the research moving forward. So for instance, just on the first day of this workshop, we heard a lot of comments about how science and policy now interact in ways that are new and historically exceptional. We talked about how scientific interventions must operate across different value contexts that can't be reconciled. And it was also emphasized that the work of climate interventions is equally a scientific and social enterprise. And so this all spells very new roles for how the social science and humanities can be collaborating in this research in ways that exceed how the disciplines have been traditionally imagined and the structures for their interaction. So for myself, for instance, as a humanities scholar, typically the imagined capacity for a humanities scholar has been limited to the role of a communicator of the science or an ethical analyst of the science or an analyst of the social impacts of the science. And this typically happens after the findings have been made or the technological interventions have been proposed. However, the research complexities and uncertainties and risks really call for new structures that enable various disciplinary experts to co-create research questions and trajectories together. So much of what we'll have to say today will be to emphasize that this kind of work requires real changes in how the research is funded and supported. So John, I'll turn it back to you.
Yeah, one of our big take-home points for today is that a team can certainly learn to become interdisciplinary, but as I said before, it doesn't happen quickly. It doesn't happen over a week-long workshop. It takes hundreds of hours of effort for that team to really learn to become functional. And then the second, more academic question is, how does a team become transdisciplinary? And you know, there could be different interpretations of transdisciplinary versus interdisciplinary. Our experience, though, is that the transdisciplinary journey takes years to complete. And that is in conflict, I think, with much of what is said now of how research needs to be accelerated and becoming transdisciplinary. So we were invited here today, likely because we wrote this paper on ARPA-C, which you've probably heard of. So Advanced Research Projects on Climate. The point that I'll make with this slide is that the five authors you see here are each transdisciplinary in different ways, with combining different fields. And we wrote this paper largely because we're interested in this topic, and we knew that this wasn't going to be a single discipline solution for many of these interventions. So we started a weekly conversation in 2019, and this was the typical and best of the academic experience, unfunded, spontaneous, and simply because, enjoyment to enrich ourselves. It took us 2 years to become a functioning communicative group to where we could actually produce a commentary in Earth's future. And so these images that I've selected here, I created them on OpenAI's DALL-E program. And I asked DALL-E to create pictures of transdisciplinary scientists learning to communicate over a multi-year period. And what I like about these is, most of the time, if you look at this middle one here up at the top, we sit on our own pillars and we talk past each other. That's often what happens when scientists come together from different disciplines. We've evolved, our disciplines have evolved, that we just can't communicate effectively. And it literally took us 2 years of arguing and learning a common language to where we could come to conciliate and we could converge, right, on even producing a commentary. Our work aligns really well with the 2022 NASEM ESS report on future Earth sciences. What we liked about the classic ARPA model is that it's kind of anti-government in the way that it's nimble. It has much more funding and it's flexible and it's high risk. And those of us who have spent a career being funded by the US government know that those adjectives aren't often used with our funding agencies. Similar to the report, we called for transdisciplinary research, we called for convergence, public-private partnerships, and this idea that we're not going to do this as academics. It really has to be this collaboration with the private sector and with NGOs and incorporating social science and social systems as well. We were fortunate in that we did actually manage to produce some impact in an academic sense with this paper. So we did present to the Department of Energy. The Biden-Harris administration did take up this idea. And we it was also requested by Gina McCarthy's her office to incorporate into the for the latest the last bill, the infrastructure bill. As most of you know, the ARPA-C did not actually come to fruition, but I think for an academic, even getting a politician to listen to your ideas and to pay attention is a mark of success. Okay, so quickly, why transdisciplinary research? I think clearly this workshop has highlighted that the science is different, and there are these really complex couplings between human-made and Earth system. I think if you take home anything from this slide, and this is really just findings from our commentary, transdisciplinarity, the second point, enables assessment of complex externalities. What we mean by that is, if you're thinking about solar geoengineering, can it affect crop yields, in another part of the world? Can it affect infectious disease transmission? Externalities by their nature manifest outside of disciplinary boundaries, and large-scale human efforts are just ripe with these externalities of the original discipline, not even conceiving an endpoint of their science or the impact in a totally different field, right? And it's externalities are really about risk. And finding and elucidating and quantifying these externalities, it's really challenging, but it doesn't happen in a single discipline. We also have, of course, things like equity and justice, and equity is self-sustaining. Prioritizing human well-being is really important, as Lynn will point out in a second. If you focus solely on the technology development, you're going to run into some serious red flags when you try and implement. And that's been clearly a theme for this workshop. Before we move on, Lynn, anything you want to add to this slide?
No, I think you covered it well. Just that ARPA-C work really was inspired by noting that climate interventions must operate in these kind of entrenched social and natural systems that have complex feedback loops, unpredictable tipping points, and that the science was now being asked to intervene in new ways that was as much social and political as it was scientific or technological. That covers it. Oh, great. So as we were working on this ARPA-C work, we did much of this work during the COVID-19 pandemic, and we found it to be a very compelling and appropriate parallel example to climate intervention research. So this is just a study that attempted to model the kind of factors and causal loops and feedback loops of how the pandemic unfolded. And so we were kind of observing that while the vaccine program resulted in a really historic scientific achievement, the trajectory of the pandemic was really strongly shaped in unpredictable ways by social and cultural factors such as vaccine hesitancy and misinformation and access to resources. And John, I know we talked a lot about this during the process. Is there anything you wanted to add to this point?
The simple point here for climate scientists is that with the COVID-19 pandemic, we got the technology. We got the moonshot technology and it worked. And we would all agree that we still didn't win in the way we thought we could, right? And I think that is a really important and profound implication for future scientific research going forward in coupled human natural systems.
Actually, could you go back to the COVID slide? Yeah, I just wanted to make one point that I think it's very interesting, this attempt to model the culture and cultural factors of the pandemic. So in looking at this model, you can see that just one section is labeled social, which involves elements like trust in governments and fake news, which feed into perception and cognition in this model. And if you look closely at the other sections, though, you'll see that they all contain strong social and cultural factors. So before we begin discussing some of our recommendations for transdisciplinary science, I think it's worth taking a moment to elaborate how integrated the social complexities are in the science itself as a way to help inform and justify these recommendations. So next slide, please. So there's some recent models in climate science that also attempt to model social natural interactions in the climate system. And here are two just example studies. This one is Determinants of the Emission Pathways in Coupled Climate Social Systems, published in 2022. And the next one is Linking Models of Human Behavior and Climate Alters Projected Climate Change. So what I find interesting about these two examples is that they signal an attempt to address the sort of fundamental natural social complexities that we've been discussing here in the science itself. These are attempts to explain and model how human actions at a meta scale create, help inform climate projections and scenarios. And while the task of modeling these cultural dynamics and behavioral patterns has not been a component of many mainstream Earth system science scenarios in the past, we now see the development of these CSMs or climate social models to address these complexities. And as was briefly discussed in the first day of this workshop, this work is in its very early stages. We have a great deal to consider if human behaviors and cultural trends are going to be built into the climate models. And in light of these developments and following the ARPA-C work, I followed up with some secondary studies. So you can go to the next slide. One is a single author piece framed for a science and technology studies journal. And the second is another co-authored piece that I've written alongside of colleagues at CSU, Dr. Pat Keyes in atmospheric science and Dr. Raker Warrior in human dimensions of natural resources. And we wrote this piece framed for a commentary in the scientific community, and a preprint of that is now available. By the time this reaches publication, it will probably also be about a 2-year process for this collaboration from start to finish. So in this study, we look at how climate scenarios and pathways have become very powerful forms of knowledge statements. And they're among the primary statements guiding the actions and decisions of global governments and institutions. And so in this article, we consider examples from the International Energy Agency scenarios, the shared economic pathways, and others to examine how these scenarios require numerous interpretive decisions about how to model aggregate human behavior and cultural trends that are relevant to climate forcing agents. And so specifically, we analyze how these scenarios and pathways are quite value-laden, but they're simultaneously structuring and constraining the academic and political conversations about climate interventions, what interventions are on the table or even considered possible. And secondly, we explore how these scenarios may be actually entraining certain climate social futures and informing climate interventions that are put forward. So some of the conclusions that we come to in this piece resonate with comments that we heard on the first day of this workshop about how climate modeling mostly considers very simplified human scenarios, that these narratives we generate about the future are guiding the science in really obscure ways, and that we should consider how the science might be generating pathways and demands for certain interventions while simultaneously leaving others out of the picture. So our article concludes with some recommendations for bringing more methodological clarity and contextual framing and reflective analysis in climate social scenarios. And these steps could ultimately aim to help build trust and enhance climate scenario transparency, so that there can be a more informed political and democratic process regarding these pathways. These are some small actionable steps towards creating more democratic and inclusive discourse that many speakers in this workshop have articulated the need for. So for instance, how do we begin to probe the values that frame our definition of sustainable and development? What would it mean to seriously include a donut economic pathway in the next round of climate discussions? So these are deeply ethical and social questions, and to begin to address them will need new forms of transdisciplinary research that really is about co-creation of research questions and agendas. So with that, we can begin to conclude and offer some recommendations. So our paper on ARPA-C outlined a set of preliminary recommendations for transdisciplinary research. And I want to be clear that these points that we'll make don't address all of the complexities that have been repeatedly raised over this workshop, which concern what ethical governance guidelines and standards are needed for the science, how do we build institutions that can inclusively and democratically govern planetary scale interventions, and in the absence of those structures, there'll still be a case for an international non-use agreement, And finally, what structures and institutions are needed to conduct public assessment and agreement exercises that can meaningfully interact with scientific agendas? So these are much larger questions. And so these recommendations address just the transdisciplinary model of science that we offer in the ARPA-C paper. So the first is really that we need a diverse team structure. And this will take a lot of hours and paid protective time for that to become functional. And I think that the National Academies report on Earth System Science made some really excellent points about the reality of convergent center teams and how much time they would need to develop a shared language and vocabulary and what additional training may be needed to make those teams work. The second is also a point that I believe we've heard other iterations of in this workshop.
Then I think we're out of time.
We need a review process throughout the research trajectory and not just at the beginning and end. So John, I'll let you finish.
Yeah, so I've made the point about epistemic growth that not happening quickly. I think what I'll do is just end on our final slide here. This is a bit more of a challenging statement. There's not a lot of evidence out there that transdisciplinary research produces more impact than traditional ones. And I know this because I've reviewed a lot of reports, especially by the NASEM, on transdisciplinary research, and they're mostly self-citing. It's a bunch of academics saying, this sounds good, and I think it sounds good. I think it sounds great. And yet there hasn't been a rigorous review of, you know, the transdisciplinary process in and of itself, or the impact it can produce. I think, so we're all in agreement that this sounds like a good idea, but no one has really studied it from a mechanistic standpoint. This is where we think the NASEM in collaboration with the NSF could really, you know, work to generate some new knowledge here. And so I'll maybe just end here on this last slide. And Lynn, I don't know if you want to add anything, but I think we're past time, so.
No, we're good, thank you.
Great. Thank you, John and Lynn, so much for that. Clearly, there is so much of a discussion to be had here, and you've provided some really rich foundation for this session. So thank you for kicking us off. In the interest of time, I'm going to save my comments, and we can move through our panelists at a good clip, and then we can save everything for a rich discussion afterwards. So I'd like to introduce James Arnott from the Aspen Global Change Institute. We can see your slides, James, so take it away.
Okay, great. Well, I'm just... Okay, you can hear me. Sorry, I'm really astounded by the prior presentation. I thought it did a wonderful job of really showing the texture and the longevity that's required to achieve some of the kinds of changes in research processes that everyone has been alluding to over this great session in 2 days. And thanks to the organizers for having me. I thought I would start out with just a quick bit of history about the NSF to set the context for why all the things that we're talking about that we need are so hard to implement in practice. And you may recognize this gentleman here. I think Dr. Joellen Russell first mentioned his name. This is Vannevar Bush, who is considered one of the main architects of the National Science Foundation and really one of the main architects of the model of public science funding in our country. And if you look at how he articulated a theory of change for societally beneficial science, it stands in much contrast to the kind of science that we're talking about mobilizing on climate intervention research that would be responsible. Back in 1945, he said, scientific progress on a broad front results from the free play of free intellects working on subjects of their own choice in the manner dictated by their curiosity for exploration of the unknown. And, you know, I've really been heartened by all the comments over the past couple of days on the need for governance. One of the features of this model of funding science for many decades has been to insulate somewhat the scientific community from the kind of meaningful and sophisticated and substantial governance and oversight that perhaps is needed in the context of climate intervention research. I wanted to show these three overlapping circles, a framework that Raj Pandya came up with at the American Geophysical Union, just to show some of the different orientations to science convergence being doing work at the intersection of disciplines, collaboration between research and practice or research and policy, and justice, trying to rectify past and current harms to marginalized populations. Each of these orientations are needed, I think, in the kind of science that we need on climate intervention research. They're not all exactly the same, but we also have to find a way for how they can all come together. And many of the ideas about research approaches within each of these circles are the kinds of ideas relevant to doing post-normal science that Dr. Flegel talked about on the first day. How do we address these complex value-laden uncertainty challenges? My research on science funding really asks the question of when is it appropriate to shift the paradigm in how we manage public investments in science? And this framework that I show here just quickly came about after interviewing dozens of program managers in public agencies in the earth and environmental sciences in the Western scientific world, primarily in North America and Europe. And one of the things that came out after all of these conversations across many different institutions, including former program managers at the NSF, is that there is a mentality among some program managers that really posed closely to the Vannevar Bush approach, where the expectation for science is about discovery, and the approach of program management is very hands-off. It's very what many program managers refer to as community-driven, and by the community, they mean the scientific community. And when we move into a more actionable science framework that includes interdisciplinarity, transdisciplinarity, collaboration across science, policy, and practice, and including these questions about justice and equity, all of the issues that are on the table of the Next Generation Earth System Science report that a previous speaker spoke to, it may require a shift of part of our public science enterprise into a more problem-solving mode and into a more proactive mode of program management. One of the things I wanted to mention about Vannevar Bush, he wrote this pamphlet, Science, the Endless Frontier. That endless frontier concept has stuck with us. A predecessor to the CHIPS Act was called the Endless Frontiers Act, which ended up being passed through the CHIPS Act and doubled the size of the National Science Foundation and created a $5 billion new director called Technology, Innovation, and Partnerships, which I think is a big piece of the puzzle that we might consider in this meeting. I'll just end with this image here, just to say that program managers across many different organizations are thinking about different ways to innovate in the design of the solicitation, who is involved and how proposal review processes are organized, the kinds of support that might be provided to researchers beyond financial support. I think particularly in the climate intervention world, that could include legal assistance, communications assistance, thinking through really tough questions around governance. And then how do we evaluate these programs? Part of the issue is that we don't really think about program management as a systematic object of study oftentimes. And so we don't often learn as much as we can from different inventions and innovations and how we manage programs. And perhaps climate intervention research provides an opportunity to think a little bit more systematically, critically, and empirically about how we fund science. So with that, I'll say thank you and look forward to the conversation.
Thank you, James, as will we. That was a nice follow-on. Next up, we have Bill Easterling from Penn State University. And we can see your screens now. Yeah, if you want to put it in slideshow mode.
Going to. Okay, thank you.
Perfect. Yep, we got it. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. One thing that was missing from my bio that is important here is that between 2017 and 2021, I served as the assistant director of NSF in charge of the geosciences directorate. And why that's important is that it was during my my time at NSF that we commissioned the Earth Systems study from the Academy. And it was specifically requested because it was very clear that Earth system science was really popping up in a lot of places. For example, NCAR was referring to its lead research climate model as the Earth system model. And it, you know, I realized early on that that we really had kind of lost our way with regard to Earth system science over the past several years, and that this was just a good opportunity to bring it back to the fore. Let me get this lined up properly here. I really am just going to share a few issues that I think are important, primarily taking a inside NSF looking out point of view. And let me just start. I was struck by Margaret's comment last session that she was reluctant to, come out in favor of any particular CI technology until there had been a chance to take a whole systems view of any of the technologies and to understand some of the direct and indirect consequences of moving forward with any one of them, because that's precisely what NSF's core strength is it is constantly advancing a more systems understanding of nature, the world, people, and how they interact with the world, and how the climate problem is ultimately viewed. And it was really out of that kind of root understanding that that the whole idea of convergence science emerged at NSF, which really kind of came to the fore while I was there at the foundation. And it was really an effort to try to involve the entire chain of knowledge development from basic research to applied research, and particularly actively promotes issues of diversity and inclusion. And it really, at its core, is driven by a very specific and compelling problem, and whether that problem arises from questions that have never been asked before, or out of very clear pressing societal needs. And like so much of the transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary research that before it, it shows deep integration across disciplines. Now, here's the key point, and the reason why I thought it was important that NSF take this, this step to engage with the Academy on this study was that NSF, and I know this is no surprise to many of you, incredibly stovepiped organization. I'm encouraged by the new technology innovation and participation partnership directorate, and that may get us into a much more cross-disciplinary framework. Another thing that I wanted to mention here, and I hold this to be very important, is that NSF has a very large array of facilities, and I know many of you have engaged use of them. And it's important in a convergence research format that we have a much better coordinated set of individual projects that engage more than one of these facilities. And we don't, we have if I went around the horn here, we'd be here for the rest of the hour talking about these facilities. But it's important that we have better coordination in engaging these on convergent research problems. So with that, I'm going to stop and hold my powder for later on in the conversation.
Great, thank you so much, Bill. That was really good insights that we can synthesize a bit later. Appreciate it. Next up, we have Bob Kopp from Rutgers University. And I
think Bill needs to stop sharing.
Yeah, I'm trying to get it off.
Thank you.
All right. So thanks. Great discussion both today and Tuesday and today. I think I am here for a number of reasons, but one of which is that I'm PI of one of the large scale coastline and people hubs NSF currently funds, which and that program is often taken sort of as a model of transdisciplinary or convergent or system science. I think some of what I'm going to sound may sound a little bit like some notes of skepticism and caution about how we think about design it. So what I wanted to do is offer a few general observations that have converged in my mind over the last couple of days, and then one schematic of how this might be actually implemented at NSF. So a few observations. We've heard the phrase post-normal science a number of times. I think that in a post-normal science program, you really have to elevate the investment in ethics and governance and science studies to be core elements, sometimes as I believe drivers of projects. Second, responding to James' point about actionable science is good, but we have lots of mission-driven science agencies, and we do have to be cognizant that NSF should not in this space turn itself into DOE. NSF's primary mission is and should remain the broad health of the U.S. scientific enterprise, not running very focused applied technology programs. There's a tendency, I think, and a desire in many ways because it helps bring people together without putting a lot of burden on the agency to do more research through large center type programs like the one I lead. And I think those can certainly have their role and can be efficient in achieving certain objectives in the short run, but by their very nature, centers include some people and exclude a whole bunch of other people. And I think it's not necessarily great for the broad health of the enterprise if that becomes a dominant means of funding convergence research. And I also think it's something I wish perhaps we had done, that when you do have big center programs, they should be strongly encouraged to include competed funds in their budget. Like effectively, those centers are partially serving as delegated program managers for NSF. Third point, convergence is critical. A system science approach is critical to thinking about this problem, but that doesn't mean that every funded project has to be convergent. The program needs to be convergent. Sometimes that means a project's convergence, sometimes it means the programs funds different people's projects and lift them together. And I think that really requires coordination investments that are not being made now. Research coordination networks exist at NSF. From my perspective, they're largely used for generating ideas for new projects. And then when projects are funded, program managers say, okay, let's bring you all to a PI meeting and you guys figure out how to talk to one another. And no, we don't have money to fund people to actually make sure that coordination happens. If coordination is key, which it is in a convergent context, that needs to be funded and something like the research coordination network model be useful. Here's a schematic for one approach. So I see sort of four programs that emerge from what I've heard discussed over the last couple of days. So one, I think we clearly need more investment in studying global climate risk management. The SCRIM SCRIM Center led by Klaus Keller at Penn State in the 2010s was held up as one of the few examples of large-scale NSF investment in climate intervention related assessment in the last decade. And the question of how we characterize, evaluate across scales and values, trade-offs among climate strategies has to be an integrative thing. And that really requires a convergence approach at the project level. So lots of things sit under this umbrella of having to do this. We need Earth system models. We need people looking at values. We need economics. This benefits strongly from international engagement. I don't think this is a climate intervention specific program.
1 minute.
We need to be able to ask, how do we think about the trade-offs between 1.5 degrees with SRM versus 2 degrees without SRM? We also need to think about different pathways of achieving 1.5 or 2 degrees. Second bucket, I think, is looking at specific technical solutions. There was a Dear Colleagues level on innovative solutions to climate change a couple of years ago, so it sort of got at what is needed there. We think that requires a convergence approach at a programmatic level, but not always for individual projects. And I do think as we think about climate intervention NSF in particular has a role to think broadly, and you don't want to scope it so that only those three buckets we talked about today are included in the program. Third, where I do think we need large centers are on global centers for assessment ethics and governance to deal particularly with the ethically challenging issues around climate intervention, particularly solar radiation management. And NSF has to be careful not to cross very hard to figure out red lines with SRM research without first investing and developing ethics and governance that will enable those to happen ethically and governly. And investing in these large centers with international partners can also be a way of developing the capacity for review of potential and ongoing projects. And finally, to link all of these together, as I said, you need to invest in research coordination networks, not preliminary to help develop proposals, but actually to say, okay, we've invested in these projects and we want them to converge across projects that need resources too. Thanks.
Great, thank you so much, Bob. Lots there. We'll move on to Mike Oppenheimer at this time, who I think you don't have slides, so you'll be speaking.
I'll just be speaking, hopefully quickly.
Wonderful. Go ahead.
So I very much appreciate the opportunity to join this panel today, although like Bob, I'm not 100% sure why I was asked. My background specific to the issues before us includes co-authoring a paper on climate intervention with Bob and David Morrow at the time of the Asilomar Conference on Geoengineering entitled Toward Ethical Norms and Institutions for Climate Engineering Research. The same year I co-authored the Academy's report on liquid transportation fuels for coal and biomass, writing a section on the benefits of early public involvement in determining rules for safely siting and operating carbon dioxide sequestration operations, an issue that already confronts large-scale CDR deployment. Later, I co-authored on the design of an international governance framework for geoengineering. And I've also benefited from NSF funding for both the physical science programs and the decision risk and management program, among others. In the process, I became convinced that sooner or later, the sooner we develop a national and eventually global framework for governing experimentation with solar radiation management, the better. The lessons learned in the process would be extremely useful in grappling with the international governance of potential implementation of SRM, including the issue of whether to let SRM proceed at all. Some, but not all, of the issues raised by the prospect of SRM are also pertinent to CDR. To design an approach to reach either objective, that is, what, where, how, to what end, experimentation and or implementation should be allowed, if at all, we need a coherent knowledge base, one grounded in natural science, social science, and the many disciplines that deal with culture, values, and ethics, as we've heard earlier in this session. In other words, convergent multidisciplinary research engaging with stakeholders internationally. That's a sprawling chore. Since a few experiments aimed at elucidating various aspects of SRM in particular, but other kinds of geoengineering have already been carried out and others are in various stages of planning, we're starting late and it is timely for NSF to identify, catalyze, and support development of the complex knowledge system needed to do the appropriate level of governance. Right now, scientific research in this domain threatens to proceed unmoored, and we need both bearings and moorings very quickly. Let me give you an example of the kind of question that needs a focused effort of this sort to yield material useful to policymakers. Last March, an expert who advocates for experimentation dropped by my office to continue an ongoing conversation, or you could call it an argument, about SRM-related experimentation. My position was and is that no experiments outside the laboratory or computer should be allowed until a governance framework is in place for determining what is safe and what is not, what is fair and what is not. For me and others, the bright line of inside, outside, that is in the ambient air or inside, provides the clearest, safest demarcation and a sure way to avoid a slippery slope toward any experiment of any magnitude, which then verges on implementation. My friendly adversary mentioned some of the problems with my formulation, including that the experiments motivated by SRM are not very different, if at all, to some of the experiments already carried out in the ambient atmosphere in order to understand climate change itself.
Of course, 1 minute.
Leaving aside the question of whether motivation matters in this situation, which itself is an excellent topic for convergent research, I challenged my friend to tell me where they would draw the line. We went back and forth all that and agreed that it would be useful to develop a formal process for doing so, something that, in my view, simply cannot be accomplished without convergent research reaching well beyond the physical and biological sciences into the realm of social science, ethics, and so forth. The day has come for NSF to expand its somewhat gingerly approach to such novel research forms and start building the capacity to address not merely climate intervention, but such other questions as arise in the vast landscape of climate change and beyond, like AI. In closing, let me point to just one example beyond SRM, beyond geoengineering, climate intervention, but still within the climate domain. What are the ways to think about the question of where responsibility for damages lies, that is attribution broadly applied, for the majority of damaging climate events and trends for which a fractional attribution of impacts to greenhouse gases cannot yet be done? In other words, where differentiating the impacts of climate variability versus climate change is not yet possible. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Mike, for that. And not least at all, but last, we have Benjamin Sobukle from Boston University. And so, Benjamin, I think you do have slides. Yep. And we can see them now.
Thank you. Perfect. Boy, I wish I wasn't going last. Really hard to follow all of these really interesting thoughts. And I wanted to go in a little bit of a different direction. Even though I'm principal investigator of a large grant on geoengineering, I wanted to talk more about the value of social sciences and the arts and humanities. So as we think about involving the NSF or other groups, why do these sorts of disciplines matter? And I'm gonna start with a slide that violates every rule of PowerPoint, but it's the only way I could fit it on from an article that I did with Paul and Tom a few years ago. And the kind of, this looks at different dimensions of risk, whether it's the availability of resources or resilience or security or sustainability. And as you can see, for every single energy system we have in the table, there are positive risks and negative risks. No such thing as risk-free energy. And of course, we did this many years ago. We could easily make one about risk-risk trade-offs for solar geoengineering or carbon removal. And I really wanted to underscore that, you know, how these risks across all these different systems are depicted, defined, and communicated. That's the arts and humanities. But how they're actually connected to engineering and prototype designs, how they may have pollution impacts or life cycle impacts, that's engineering. How we determine who they affect vulnerability for, dose response functions, disability adjusted life years, that's the health and life sciences community. How we model those risks, arguably the natural sciences, economics, integrated assessment modeling communities. And then how we actually interpret these risks, deconstruct them, plan for them, make policy for them, distribute them, and socialize them, well, that's the social sciences, broadly defined. And so no single discipline has a monopoly on how we understand these risks, and only through a kind of myopic almost approach, cutting across all of these disciplines, can we actually get a more comprehensive notion of risk. The other thing that's kind of neat, I was quite persuaded by my colleague Daniel Spreng, who built on Max Neef's work about disciplines, that shows how they exist not in a hierarchy of validity, but in a hierarchy of meaning. And what I really like about this diagram is it does show a role for all sorts of disciplines, even things like philosophy and ethics and values, how they connect to things like planning and politics, which also connect to things like gender and development, which also connect to the more fundamental sciences like physics and buildings, statistics, and linguistics. And so I kind of like this, is that, you know, all disciplines can have inform each other, and they can help kind of contribute to a more holistic sense. And each set of inquiry is also pegged to different types of questions: empirical questions, pragmatic questions, normative questions. Lastly, this is my last slide. I also wanted to kind of come back to what social science is, because I think that for many people, it is simply the kind of Max Neef diagram of disciplines. But as a fierce advocate of social science work, I often tell my colleagues, it's far more than just disciplines, right? It is definitely an epistemic community of scholars. You know, I think at last count, there were 11 million self-defined social scientists in the world working on various things. It is also a way of doing research that often complements many of the ways of doing research we've spoken about here. And so usually human-centered behavioral approaches to research through interviews and focus groups and surveys and household diaries and site visits and ethnography and anthropology, which is a kind of collection of methods. It's also a collection of concepts, and to illustrate this, this beautiful diagram, which I made in PowerPoint, illustrates an article we just published a few months ago, where we asked a bunch of theorists, what heuristics should we use to understand net zero industry? And the answer we got back was there are 88 theories, 88 different families of perspectives, cutting across geography and industrial ecology and history and engineering and justice scholarship. We did another study that's not shown here, that
One
said,
minute.
What are the theories for energy transitions? And we got 94 theories. So it's even more theories than what are here. And so, you know, the social sciences have a whole basket or quagmire of different theories that help us understand phenomena and change. And finally, it's, you know, a number of different topics, many of which have come up here: risk, justice, equity, barriers, governance, social acceptance, policy, political economy. These really fall within the domain of the social sciences. So if I had the privilege ever of talking to the NSF administrator or Vannevar Bush, who founded it all 50 years ago, I would really urge them to balance this approach of the endless frontier as a scientific and physical phenomena, as well as an intimately social and ethical phenomena. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Benjamin. That was a great way to tie up the panel. And I think we're going to have, there goes my timer. We are good to go. I think we're gonna get all of our panelists up here now, which should be fantastic. And we have a good 30-34 minutes for Q&A, which I expect to be quite rich. And so I can see that our Q&A is still being populated as well, and which is, so I'll just kind of work to help bring these questions together. And so there have been a number of different topics, ideas, recommendations, proposals even, that have come up over the course of this workshop and within this panel as well. There are some kind of emerging buckets that I've been noticing of recommendations and just ways to think about this from the perspective of the NSF. Some of these are structural. So we've raised coordination issues, coordinating across directorates and programs, the use of existing systems and programs within NSF, how NSF shall handle convergence. There's another sort of bucket that's emerged on what to do about individual proposals and projects, right? What are the expectations for proposers and recipients and writing and pulling together these projects? How does funding and evaluation and monitoring differ between things that are conducted in more of a lab setting, projects that are conducted more in a lab setting versus moving out into the real world for field trials and demos? And how does NSF actually weigh in on these projects and potentially shape them? And so those are just some buckets and ways to think about this. What I've tried to do, my questions for the panel, I'm gonna ask that the panel raise their hands either using the emoji or physically, and I'll call just for a bit more structured. The questions I'm gonna pose are open to the entire panel to weigh in. And these are kind of pulling together what people are contributing right now, as well as what has been raised earlier on in previous sessions. And so the first question that I'm going to pose is sort of a mix of these questions. And so we have somebody had just raised, and I'm actually trying to see where. Oh, right. So this question was posed to Bill, but I actually think it's worthwhile expanding on this. And that is that the National Academies this week held a workshop with China's National Academies on collaboration between the U.S. and China on climate change. And I want to pair that particular question, which is how do we see prospects for collaborations on climate interventions, with a comment that was raised in the first session, I believe,
about internationalization of climate intervention research and how the NSF can promote this. This is particularly pertinent when we think about research partners, but also impacts and representation across the global South. And this is not just with respect to funding, but also designing research questions and even the solicitations themselves. And this idea of international collaboration was raised with respect to the comment that national research organizations need to gain some sort of global legitimacy, particularly if they want to be funding climate intervention research. And then there are some issues of coordination. Bob, I think you'd raise that across the NSF, but I think this is even larger scale when we're thinking about co-funding or collaborating across national borders. So that's sort of a group of questions, and I offer that up as a first set of questions for the panelists to respond to. And I would say whoever would like to, Bill, if you'd like to start off, given your experience, and the original question on China was directed towards you, and then we can move on to others.
Yeah, it's a good question. And, you know, in my experience at NSF, the NSF is not as fleet of foot in cooperating internationally with their sort of similar agencies in other countries. I mean, there's some very good exceptions to that case. The Thwaites Glacier, which I know many in the audience are very much aware of the danger we all face of the instability of Thwaites in Antarctica is being studied and understood by a very robust team of British and US scientists funded by NSF and jointly NSF and the UK Research and Innovation Agency. But most of the international projects that NSF is engaged in are one-off, special arrangements. There is no template per se, and I think personally that climate intervention is of the perfect case study for NSF to begin to develop new mechanisms for promoting cooperation with partnering agencies across the world, not just always being inside the U.S.
Bob, did I see? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So one thing. So I used for my on the right column on my side the global center phrase, and that was intentional reference to an ongoing call at NSF for global centers for use inspired research addressing global challenges in climate and energy. So that has no track record. It's new, but I think it is an attempt to do something new in the space. Right now, it's just a collaboration with other wealthy European descended countries. But I think that I tried to project a little bit of skepticism in my remarks about doing too many like big projects as opposed to more broadly funding groups. But I think in the case of things that affect governance that require a lot of coordination, that is a situation in which you need these global centers. And I also think they have to address the fact that the current global center call is only which northern countries. And whether that's through partnership with USAID or something so that we can actually get money outside the US, but somehow that needs to be taken into account too.
Right. Thank you. Benjamin, yeah.
Yeah, building on these comments. Challenges-based research calls like Horizon Europe, Horizon 2020, I think someone mentioned the Global Challenges Research Fund in the UK, are really useful. It also fits in with the whole ARPA-E, DARPA, ARPA-C approach, make it around a mission or a challenge. Having joint calls among research councils, the Global Centers call is a good example. The Joint Program Initiative in Europe does this as well. I had a grant that was co-funded by the Norwegian, German, French, British, and Swedish research councils, kind of like the Global Centers one. The more countries you add, it goes to peer review at those research councils. And then the final one, which I'm not sure if anyone here is familiar with, I still have an affiliation in the UK, and they've started doing things through what's called a champion call. So this is a kind of non-competitive exclusive call where they'll have someone apply to be the champion, champion of net zero industry, champion of hydrogen, champion of energy efficiency. That part's competitive. Then the champion spends 6 months building a team of usually like 60 or 70 co-investigators. These are big grants, 20 million pounds, 30 million pounds. And then they put together a proposal that is peer reviewed, but it's invitation only, and you're only competing against yourself. And as long as you pass peer review, and most of them do, you get the money. So there's kind of a much, much more degree of certainty and a much greater degree of coherence and less fragmentation. The way they usually create competitiveness is because obviously when you apply for the champion, it's competitive. And then there's usually a flex fund that goes through the consortium that's also competitive grants later for 100K, 200K, 300K. So there's competition at the front and the back. But what a great way to do research, because you're not wasting all of this time on proposals that have a 5% chance.
Yeah, Mike, please.
This comment doesn't go to the international aspect in particular, but does go to the comment that Bill made and that I certainly agree with, that NSF isn't exactly fleet of foot. There was an opportunity about a dozen years ago. I put a project together with Dale Jameson and Naomi Oreskes aimed at doing ethnographic work on assessments. And it had to cut across disciplines. I mean, I knew nothing about ethnography. Dale and Naomi knew some. I was a physical scientist on the project. And there was an NSF opportunity where different programs or divisions, I'm not sure how it's categorized, were supposed to join together to co-fund a project. It looks like sort of a nascent way to fund convergent research like this was, in a sense. And they couldn't quite pull it off. They couldn't quite reach agreement, the physical science division and I think the science studies people. So Bob O'Connor, who is in charge of risk, I guess, stepped in and just made it happen. We got the funding and it led to quite substantial funding for that arena. And then it grew into an ongoing project, which still goes on. It got funded again by NSF and the project, which is now I step back from because I was an IPCC author and I had a conflict, is now in six assessment, completed an ethnographic study in author meetings of AR6. So that would never have happened if at the beginning, one of the people who I guess is more innovative or had an interest in this kind of research was willing to step forward and make something happen where even the mechanism in NSF set up to make different parts of the sciences get together failed to do it. So it can be done even in a relatively rigid bureaucracy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, could add.
Yeah, please. Thing. Yeah, sorry, Bob.
Michael's comment about what's being at the point about Bob O'Connor and decision science program. I think one of the things that I think has emerged as a theme here is that the sort of implicit power hierarchy among disciplines has to be somewhat inverted or at least more equalized in this space. That really, if our goal is to support decisions, right? I mean, and again, I'm cautious about defining our sole goal that way, but part of it is to do use-inspired research. Then the people who study decisions and how people make them have to be in driver's seats, right? And the decision science program has done a lot of interesting things with a small budget, but SBE is always the smallest, I think, of the directorates in terms of funding and really needs to be elevated to more of a leadership role in the context of everything we're talking about.
Great, thank you. And we have so many more questions coming in, so we could spend an entire time talking about this, but I am gonna move on to just a couple of other questions and hopefully we can fit these all in. So there's questions about convergence, about stage gating, about the role of technology. I think one thing that seems to be arising across our audience right now is a question that I think particularly pertinent to Lynn and John and what you presented about timescales. And so, this question crosscuts a couple of different ideas and topics. So one, you know, with respect to taking advantage of natural experiments, you know, there's a question there about NSF mobilizing programs or funding to take advantage of natural experiments when they happen, as a way of as a means of learning. So that's one kind of timescale question. But the other is sort of reconciling the different timescales to become transdisciplinary or to become interdisciplinary, which is sort of emerging from this conversation as something that's desperately needed within this space, against the urgency of the crisis and needing to deploy some of these technologies. But we've also heard across the different panels about the relative timescales of some of these technologies. Some of them are in their infancy. When you start to look at land-based CDR, we're already moving forward with markets and other sorts of mechanisms. So there's some heterogeneity, right, of course, in the temporal availability of some of these technologies, but it's sort of reconciling what needs to happen to represent these different perspectives, to represent convert or transdisciplinary research, and reconciling that with the time needs for climate intervention. So that's sort of the broad question. And maybe Lynn, John, this might be a good way to sort of kick off kick off that discussion, and then we can take in other people. Yeah.
Sure, I'm happy to start, and John, please chime in. But I think in answer to the question of the timelines and the risks of failure of these projects, I think it is just important to reiterate the fact that a lot of this research that's happening now in this kind of way is not supported in the ways that would accelerate it. And so supporting this research, in ways that allows for the sort of ad hoc methodologies that people on Tuesday's call workshop described having to develop, that John described our group having to develop, and that those things would have the kind of investment and support that would be needed to accelerate them. And then also to just reiterate Bob's comment about elevating the importance of and leadership of the social sciences and humanities in those conversations, because the institutional support for disciplines like I'm in is not there, honestly, for the time it takes and the investment it takes to develop some of these initiatives. For the ARPA-C and the climate scenario work, this was all just done in an unsupported way. And so that could absolutely be accelerated with the type of support we kind of outlined in the ARPA-C article.
Thanks very much. Yeah,
I'll just reinforce what Lynn said about academic institutions not being well suited to support this sort of radical research. The academic model is, I will work on this project. I have four projects because I need to support graduate students and I need to teach. And so I'll put 1 month of my time. If you're talking about accelerating, you're talking needing to fund 9 months of someone's time. They need to go all in on these sorts of activities if you want them to be accelerated. Otherwise, they're going to take 2 years until you can learn the playbook and the language to communicate across these disciplines. My fear is that what's going to happen with the term transdisciplinary research is it's going to follow in the footsteps of what we used to say in the early 2000s, the pursuit of excellence, right? That was what we all used to say in our academy. And now in the late last decade, it was living my best life, right? I'm living my best life right now, which is this kind of hollow statement of projecting something that you say you're doing, but you're really not. And so I think, you know, the biggest take home we have from our learnings here is that this idea of really doing interdisciplinary or transdisciplinary research takes much more time and effort. And to achieve that protected time for the investigators, the funding model has to really radically change, and the institutions who employ these researchers have to change. That's the real challenge.
Thank you. I will go to Bill and then Bob, and I do have a technology question I'd like to squeeze in.
Yeah, one of the deep mysteries to me when I was at NSF was the almost slavish adherence to 3 years for the, you know, the period of research for any standard NSF grant. Now, mind you, some of the larger STC and, you know, science technology center, large centers type grants and some of the new convergence accelerator grants are being awarded at 5 year and with expectation of 10 year 10 year performance. And what I thought would be a radical idea for NSF, and I had trouble getting any traction for it at all, is we really need for some of these radical new ideas that will require a lot of testing before they're ever allowed out the gate into the market. A 20-year period would not be at all unreasonable for a team of researchers to be, you know, funded, and it could even be a changeable team. But this is something that NSF is going to have to really be moved on because it's outside the norms of the organization right now.
Thank you, Bob, and then James.
Yeah, so I want to come to a couple of key points. So what I said before, NSF's mission ultimately is the health of the scientific enterprise. That's different from an agency like the Department of Energy. That means we're going to have some natural minimum timescales in our work that have to do with the time it takes for students to do theses and postdocs to do their work. And if you want to do something a lot faster than that, it's probably not the right mechanism. You probably want a contract from a mission-driven agency for that. I agree with Bill that longer-term investments is key to allowing space to develop that transdisciplinary collaboration. I would be a little nervous about 20 years because that sounds sort of like redeveloping the national lab model. And at that point, you are really talking about an applied technology program. And why is that NSF as opposed to DOE doing that in the first place? I think that needs careful considerations. And then the other thing I would say, I think and academic institutions have to step up their game. There are a lot of institutional barriers to transdisciplinary work, particularly to publicly engaged work in terms of things like what is considered for promotion and tenure. And I think it would be quite reasonable for the academic community to develop some guidelines for that, and then for the funders to sort of enforce those with a little bit of a stick to make sure that they are investing their money in universities that are prepared to make sure that doing this sort of work is a way to a sustainable career for people.
Great. Thank you very much, James.
Yeah, and Sonali, I know you want to get to the next question. Oh, I'm sitting here, I think, my work is really about questioning when is it appropriate to shift into different mentalities, mechanisms, modes, myths about the function of science in society. And it just strikes me that given the gravity of what we know about climate change and what we've heard over the last couple of days about climate intervention, that it might be worth thinking about the role of the NSF, not in terms of the lane that it has maintained over the last 75 years of its history, but really what kind of structure is needed moving forward into the 21st century, into the domain of post-normal science that I think we all embrace is at the, you know, crux of doing climate intervention research. I think one thing I always turn to is really how young the NSF is. 75 years is not a long time, especially if we're talking about doing experiments on the Earth that will have decadal, if not centennial or millennial implications. There are a lot of, I think, imagined trade-offs between basic and applied and deployed approaches to doing research that may not actually be as real in practice as they have been assumed in the founding of the NSF. And there is a really interesting opportunity right now where the size of the NSF is set to double over the next 5 years. And the NSF is about a $10 billion a year organization. The new TIP directorate is scheduled to be up to a $5 billion a year effort organized around technology innovations and partnerships. And so I think if we don't imagine what a different institutional structure could be at this point with something as important as climate intervention, I don't know at what point there might be another opportunity to decide.
Actually, James, that was leading right into my question, which was going to be for you anyway, which was on the role of TIP and on the role of where this new funding is going. And this kind of lends itself to some questions that were brought up during the SRM panel about
you know, a desire to see technology, but not just technology development, the governance, like looking at appropriate use for technologies, at least from an SRM perspective, but seeing that kind of technology-centered, you know, component to what NSF does. And there is also this question of, with TIP too, that you might be kind of suited to address on how NSF is navigating public-private partnerships within that, and what that might mean, and what are the contours of those public-private partnerships with respect to the way that NSF thinks about funding climate intervention work. So I'll just invite you, James, to just kind of finish that thought on the TIP and maybe comment on that, and then open it up for anyone else to respond to that as well.
Yeah, and I would encourage Bill, who was optimistic about TIP. I confess I don't know as much as I should, and I don't think anyone knows exactly how TIP is going to be played out, because they're building the ship as they're flying it. I've really been encouraged by the kinds of comments I've heard come from Erwin Gardanchani, who's the acting or current director of TIP. I think he has a very broad view of what TIP can do that is true to the founding purpose around technology and innovation, but goes much broader in terms of thinking about the different partnerships between science and society that that kind of entity could assist. I mean, just to name the elephant in the room, this was essentially a congressional mandate for NSF to establish a more applied so-called directorate within what was a basic science agency. So exactly how that meld occurs is going to play out over, you know, we're going to have to see how that plays out. I'm really, the aspect of TIP that I'm most interested in is how it can support some of the foundational infrastructure for making partnership or engaged research happen. I think the kind of 10 to 15 year cycle of being equipped to do transdisciplinary research that Lynn and John spoke to so eloquently is the kind of thing that requires training from very early stages of a career and support along the way. If you're always going to have to be a black sheep, as John said, in order to make this work happen, then you're necessarily going to limit the kind of people and the number of people that can be involved in the very integrative type of research that we're talking about. So I'm really optimistic that they have this holistic view on it, but it's still emergent as far as I can tell. And maybe others have different windows into their thinking than me.
Yeah, Bill, please. Yeah.
Yeah, I think James did a good job of kind of laying out some of the the boundaries of TIP. It's the, you know, when you hear that the NSF budget is going to double over the next few years, I always caution people to realize that that does not mean that it will raise all boats. It will not. There will be a heavy TIP influence or proportion to that increase. And he's absolutely right that their Congress and another of other vested interests have a big commitment to getting NSF into the game of finishing off what was typically called the valley of death between basic research that has been the strength of NSF and practical application, however, you apply. And so it has a noble purpose, but we all feared inside the organization that it would really favor the engineering sciences and some of the more applied parts of NSF, leaving out the traditional strength in basic research. And that actually, Erwin is keenly aware of that possibility and wants to make sure that everyone understands that even the pure basic research sciences have a role in TIP. And it's basically that he believes the model for TIP is robust enough to help facilitate the advance of basic research to the next level, to the next set of basic questions that have to be asked that may or may not have a practical application. So it's not just a, you know, one size fits all kind of box for research, applied research for NSF.
Thank you. So we have about 6 minutes left. And this is another, Bob, yeah, if you had another comment on that, go for it.
No, I had a question I was hoping we could.
Okay. Oh, right. Yeah, go ahead. If you'd like to, go ahead.
Well, yep. I mean, I think that I sort of alluded to it, but we are focused on NSF, that's who's funding this, but we have a $13, $15 billion US Global Change Research Program. And I'd be curious if people have any thoughts about what the role of NSF is as compared to other agencies with respect to climate intervention.
Yeah, Benjamin, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just gonna add two additional points that haven't really been discussed very briefly. The one is that it relates partly to the NSF's credibility. You know, there's a whole lot of research that remains weird. You may have heard this in psychology. Too much research is Western educated, rich industrialized democracies. Obviously the US is one of those. But it's like, that's like 12% of the population and like 95% of our research efforts. And so if we really want to understand pesky problems with mitigation or even climate protection in the global South, we have got to change that. And the NSF has to change that as well. The second one is that I'm quite persuaded with Dan Cameron's point he made a few years ago about the need to look at mundane technologies for climate, not just the high-tech sophisticated stuff like DAC and BECCS and SMRs and hydrogen fuel cells. I mean, bicycles, cook stoves, weatherization, efficiency, windows, these things will have a far more immediate impact on people. And yet we tend not to study them because they're boring. And, you know, okay, let's study the high tech stuff. So I think a call for mundacity and a call for the global South would be two other things I would love to see.
Any other reactions to being interagency? And that was actually a coordination, you know, kind of we were talking about within and across NSF, but yeah, I think this is a broader question to be had too. Yeah, James, do you want to, and then John, yeah.
Yeah, I think the lion's share of the USGCRP cut goes to NASA and about half of that goes to satellites. So thinking about, the pie as it is, and then how you actually grow the pie to be more challenge oriented. I think thinking about it resonate with Bob's statement, if you think about the grander challenge and set up a mission for the country and for the nation to try to achieve, and then leverage all the strengths across the 13 agencies, that maybe has a greater chance of raising all the boats, as Bill was saying, than thinking about every minute decision as a trade-off between, oh, if we do this, we're sacrificing someone else's, you know, if we're doing this applied thing, we're sacrificing a basic study on this. And I think that taking it maybe one step back, thinking about it on a more strategic basis, really would mean that the NSF and all the other agencies would have to coordinate in a way that they're not coordinating right now. There's some hope that that might change with the recent climate services framework that provides a new or calls for a new coordinating role with the US Global Change Research Program. But as of now, most of that is about putting satellites in space. And so there's you know, something to look at there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah. And just, John, I'm going to go to you, but very quickly, there might be a point of clarification here that I'm seeing. Would someone, and Bill, I think you're in a good position to do this, and then we'll go right to John. Who sets the NSF budget, and does Congress have a role, is a question from the audience. And then John, I think you might take us out. Yeah. So very quick, Bill.
Oh, that's easy. Yeah. The Congress funds the budget, but the budget itself is set by the White House. So OSTP really is the lead organization that funds NSF, and it's all done through the Office of Management of the Budget, OMB. I mean, that's just a civics answer.
Right. Thank you. And John, I saw your hand up first, and then.
Yeah, I'll just say quickly, one thing during our 2-year debate, to create that commentary we wrote, because it really was just mostly arguing the whole time. We did agree that there was no federal agency that had the authority, mandate, budget, and scope to address climate change intervention. That doesn't mean that the NSF doesn't have a role to play, but because of these boundaries that exist and the social, you know, physical couplings, you know, as a health researcher, primarily I do health. I mean, I often get to NSF and I'm told, thanks, but no thanks, you do health. That's NIH, right? Now that analogy can play out in many other ways that are relevant to climate. And so that creates a conflict. And so just to repeat, the NSF really needs to think carefully about what lane they want to ride in going forward, whether they want to stay in traditional science or really get cross-cutting. And I think that that's a very serious and difficult conversation to have.
Yeah, thank you, but needs to be stated. Mike, you can take us out. It's 2:30 and then I'll turn it over to my colleague. So go ahead.
It's the problem with the climate problem. It just cuts across everything. I had this same conversation a million times recently. I work on climate adaptation a lot. And just there is no entity within the government that has responsibility. And this is something the administration is grappling with now. And what I think they would like to do, what I'd like them to do is, I've said this before, blow it up and reconstruct it. But that's a multi-decade process with no guarantee of success. And you need a strange combination of making do with what's there now, while at the same time have some people working on a much longer term agenda, whether it's science funding or implementation of what science finds out to improve what's going to happen to us, to improve outcomes. So there's no running away from this. It infects everything that anybody involved with climate does.
All right. And on that note, I want to thank our really esteemed, thoughtful panel for putting together some wonderful presentations, and it's given us as a committee a lot to think about. But at this point now, I would like to turn over to my colleague, Lily, to take us out with some final thoughts. And thank you again to the entire panel for your brains in thinking about this today.
Thank you, everyone. So I would like to say today is just like the first day, Tuesday. We had a really great talks and a very deep and enriching discussions. And I think personally, I gain a lot of ocean-based carbon dioxide removal strategies and the important roles that the NSF can continue to play in climate intervention research. So I would like to thanks for everyone for the insightful contributions to today's session. And additionally, a very special thanks goes to Jim Harrell, our committee chair, and our session chairs today, Jenna Russell and Selena McDermott, for coordinating the workshop and guiding us through today's sessions. And of course, there's a big appreciation to the National Academies and our staff for hosting and providing support to this workshop. So like personally, I feel session 4, we explored the significant potential and the challenges of ocean-based carbon dioxide removal. And some takeaways I would like to share is I heard from today's discussion, in many times people are talking about time is urgent for climate in researching for climate intervention research, not just for ocean-based CDR, but also for land-based and also solar radiation modification. So in Margaret's highlight, Jim Harrell from Tuesday, his question about 20 years from now, what information will we wish have gathered? And also Philip Boyd mentioned the next 10 years would be crucial for us to conduct research. And also Matthew mentioned this is a pivotal decade for climate intervention research. So it's like pushing right now, it's really, we need to have a right agenda to conduct the research, not just for ocean-based CDR, but for all kinds of different strategies. It's not just about the techniques. We need to understand whether the techniques works and how we're going to scale up but also we need to have the right monitoring system and the feedback system to understand the impact on the society, ecosystem, human health. And we need to think about the international governance and how coordinate with different nations and address the same issue we're facing. So I think this is the takeaway for me. I think time is urgent, and now it's the time we need to think about how are we going to structure the study, especially now we're talking about the NSF, the next session, how should we fund the study and how should we conduct the research and moving forward to think about helping decision making. So it is the right time to really think about this question. And also I really like how Jenna asked speakers to describe the success and the failure situations they think for ocean CDR. And for me, I think that's not just for the ocean CDR. There's some common features for all climate intervention. So there are speakers mentioned the succeed would be fully understanding the marine CDR. And for me, I feel it's fully understanding of all the climate intervention strategies. And we also will have a robust system of measuring, monitoring, reporting, and verification. In that way, we could have an inclusive and transparent research to have a really comprehensive understanding. And then the outcome or the impact, what we're expecting will not just for the carbon cycle or climate, but it will be to the whole climate, the environment, the society, economy, and the governance. So really hope the implementation of any of the intervention solution can leverage ecological enhancement. And also the same for the failure situation, people have different considerations. So one thing is like insufficient research might result in situations that profit motivate or like international politics are solely driven deployment. Or people worried about there's highly privatized research, just best pick certain techniques to face an unjust or meaningfulness credit system, which could have a severe impact on people or the ocean or the land, the whole climate system. And also people worried about the failure. One of the failure could be promotion of enhanced fossil fuel will be used if we use this polluting MR, the polluting ocean CDR or other climate intervention strategies. So what we needed for session four is really a good transition to session five, because at the end, people are talking about what are we really needed. We will need interdisciplinary research. We need to really the convergence of science, social, and international governments. So that goes to session five. So what kind of NSF, what kind of role NSF should play in climate intervention research? And so my impression is right now the NSF promotes the progress of science and advance the national health and welfare. And now it's organized really around more traditional academic disciplines, although there are some interdisciplinary projects like the Penn State funded by a big project about climate risk decision-making, which Rutgers has been involved and I have been involved. So based on my experience, I totally agree with Ling and Zhang. So I think training is really needed for a team to become interdisciplinary. So it is really hard to talk with different disciplines to understand each other. So this is take time to train each other to really communicate efficiently and understand different languages. This is also go back to session four, the time is critical. So we need time to train enough people to really work in this interdisciplinary field. And climate intervention really needs the focus on culture and the human. So for NSF, it's when, like, if it's purely driven by science curiosity, if we're going to move to climate intervention, which needs to focus on culture and the human. So that's a really challenge for NSF. So what we really need, I think James pointed out, NSF decided to shift its role from pure science, community-driven, the curiosity-driven, to proactive problem-solving driven, to help decision-making for climate intervention. So, and also in the discussion, there are some questions coming up whether NSF would collaborate with other nations, the research funding agency, and work more globally, trying to solve the problem of climate intervention to solve on the research topic of climate intervention. So this is, I think, also the question. I think there's something not just international collaboration, but I didn't hear, maybe I missed, but how about the collaboration just with the organizations, funding agencies in US, like the Agriculture Department of Agriculture or DOE, how NSF will work with other organization funding agencies and support this kind of research. And there's also other question raised, it's about the budget. So although NSF might raise the total budget, but it's not even distributed to different disciplines. I think Joanna mentioned it in session four, like the oceans, the funding for ocean has been really not enough. And there's always time need to educate the graduate student, postdoc, and early career scientists to really try to understand those questions. So there's always a time issue and a budget issue and how NSF gonna to balance everything and trying to move forward. So I think from today and also Tuesday's session, I learned a lot, and I really hope to see how NSF will moving forward and help funding climate intervention this topic and trying to move forward. So thank you. I will move this to Brent and Margaret.
And the Planning Committee for their invaluable expertise in shaping this workshop, Christopher Field, Sonali McDermott, Manjana Milkerit, Joellen Russell, Simone Tilms, Lily Zia, Phoebe Zarneski, and especially our chair, Jim Hurl. This workshop follows on a 2022 National Academies Consensus Study titled Next Generation Earth System Science at the National Science Foundation. I had the honor of being part of the staff team for that study, which developed and presented six key characteristics for Earth system science for use by the National Science Foundation, whose themes were echoed in the presentations and discussions you heard over the past two workshop days. The first of these characteristics is advancing both curiosity-driven and use-inspired basic research on the Earth systems across spatial, temporal, and social organization scales. We heard remarks related to the benefits of collaboration between the natural and social sciences, as well as speaking to social organization, differences in evaluating experiments at small scales, and what it might look like to monitor and evaluate these interventions at a larger scale, as well as including the use of exit ramps and stage gating, adaptive management, and incremental decision-making principles as we navigate this space. The second characteristic is facilitating convergence of social, natural, computational, and engineering sciences to advance science and inform solutions to Earth systems-related problems. Workshop participants spoke to NSF's existing successful initiatives to support interdisciplinary research throughout the length of the study process. But, as we just heard, especially on this most recent panel, there are real barriers to the establishment and endurance of transdisciplinary research. Participants have also raised the topics of what a functioning governance structure for climate intervention would look like, which would provide appropriate governance, but also allow for answering basic science questions moving forward in this area. The third characteristic, ensuring diverse, inclusive, equitable, and just approaches to Earth system science, was echoed in discussions on how to assess social and environmental justice impacts of CDR and climate intervention approaches, transparency in research and decision-making, questions of who is calling for more research and whose questions is that research seeking to answer, as well as questions about what oversight panels might look like, and NFSS's role in abiding by ethical principles and encouraging or setting both scientific and ethical standards for climate intervention research. These themes continue with the fourth characteristic, which is prioritizing engagement and partnerships with diverse stakeholders to benefit society and address Earth systems related problems at community, state, national, and international scales. Climate intervention is an area where there are debates among some members of the scientific community and public on whether the science should even be taking place. These remarks motivate considerations on multi-scalar public engagement at local, national, and international levels, the needs to internationalize research on these topics, starting from the design stage, and the potential role for NSF as a knowledge broker with different potential actors and stakeholders in this area. The fifth characteristic of next-generation Earth system science is the use of observational, computational, and modeling capabilities synergistically to accelerate discovery and convergence. This motivates questions regarding when to study some elements together or separately, and what we can learn from natural experiments. Questions like, are certain scenarios being studied, making certain futures more likely? And of course, noting the critical role of measurement, monitoring, reporting, and verification in the context of carbon removal. Finally, the sixth characteristic of educating and supporting a workforce with the skills and knowledge to effectively identify, conduct, and communicate Earth system science connects with the considerations of extending and enhancing the focus of broader impacts of grants in this area, engaging north-south and south-south capacity building and training programs, and additionally considerations on how to enhance, grow, and maintain the number of qualified individuals in the scientific workforce for which these discipline areas have been underlined. This is in addition to NSF's capacity to support means for academic institutions to break down barriers to convergence and transdisciplinary research, and of course, the potential for NSF's TIP directorate to support broader engagement in these domains. So with all of that, I will turn things over to my colleague, Margot Corum.
We lost the audio again.
What's really well-being from the economic systems into the human well-being approach in our systems? And also, what are our useful set of standards? what are our baselines? How do we move things forward in best practices? Also, what are the research and methodology gaps? This again is extremely important to understand where we're going. And this also points out, you know, we don't always have a collective best practice here. Who is involved in the research? Again, this goes back from the beginning stages of the cradle to grave. And how do we prioritize what needs to be done and what who do we need involved to actually really excel the research itself? Next slide. So now we're going to go into the similar opportunities. We all seemed very excited and had no issues with actually working amongst others in different research areas. Also, how do we adapt the options of, you know, potentially address the EJ issues? That has been discussed. It was talked about in the last session and earlier on. You know, there are mechanisms there, but it's still something, you know, these are opportunities that we can take a hold of. Also, we need to just grow the awareness of the benefits of working with our stakeholders and then the Indigenous community as well, and knowledge. This needs to be done at all levels. Again, this goes back to environmental justice, but it's really goes back into the life cycle and how we fully need to bring all these components in. And then also thinking about the generational shift in skills and engagement. This was talked about how, you know, in the oceans session, you know, what we need for the scientists and to bring these scientists up. These are all opportunities that we need to address moving things forward. Next slide. So kind of in closing, I'm just going to circle this out. So as Britt had mentioned and kind of going through the Next Generation Earth Systems report, these are all follow-on activities. So Tipping Points was the original workshop that was conducted in January. There is an ongoing roundtable on macroeconomics. So there's actually going to have a meeting which is going to be talking about the dynamics of climate and microeconomy, and that's going to be a two-day workshop in fall. And then obviously here are links. So it's the links to the website for intervention, and here are the recording links listed below. In addition to, and our last and final workshop that will be part of this series is going to be on climate and human migration. We are still in the early stages of this, and so we're planning on having that workshop in the fall. And kind of just to close this out, I'm going to echo what Brent had said in thanking our wonderful committee, our dynamic speakers and panelists, and thanking all the all the participants for taking the time out of your busy schedule to join us and asking extremely thoughtful and, you know, thought-provoking questions. And we really appreciate that. So in closing, this is the end of our workshop, and thank you all. Greatly appreciated.